ಸಂಧ್ಯಾ ಸಮಾರಂಭಕ್ಕೆ ಆಗಮಿಸಿರುವ ಎಲ್ಲ ಸಭಿಕರಿಗೂ ಮತ್ತು ಮಾನ್ಯ ಅತಿಥಿಗಳಿಗೂ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ ಪ್ರಾರಂಭದಲ್ಲೇ ಒಂದು ಸೂಚನೆ ಇಂದಿನ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮದ ಮುಖ್ಯ ಅತಿಥಿಯಾಗಿರುವಂತ ಸನ್ಮಾನ್ಯ ಶ್ರೀ ಡಿ ಎ ಜೋಸೆಫ್ ಅವರು ಪಾಂಡಿಚೇರಿಯಿಂದ ಬಂದಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಅವರು ಮುಖ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಇಂಗ್ಲಿಷ್ ನಲ್ಲಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಸಂವಾದವನ್ನ ಮಾಡುತ್ತಾರೆ ಅವರ ಉಪನ್ಯಾಸ ಕೂಡ ಇಂಗ್ಲಿಷ್ ನಲ್ಲಿ ಇರುತ್ತೆ ಕನ್ನಡ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿ ಅರ್ಥ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ ಅವರಿಗೆ ಸಂಭಾಷಣೆಗೆ ಬೇಕಾಗಿರುವಂತ ಕನ್ನಡವನ್ನ ಅವರು ಮಾತನಾಡುತ್ತಾರೆ ಕೂಡ ಆದರೆ ಸಂವಹನದ ಸಮರ್ಪಕತೆಯ ದೃಷ್ಟಿಯಿಂದ ಅವರು ಇಂಗ್ಲಿಷ್ ನಲ್ಲಿ ಮಾತನಾಡುತ್ತಾರೆ ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮದ ಒಂದು ಭಾಗ ಕನ್ನಡದಲ್ಲಿ ಇದ್ದರೆ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮದ ಪ್ರಮುಖ ಭಾಗ ಇಂಗ್ಲಿಷ್ ನಲ್ಲಿ ಇರುತ್ತೆ ಇಂದಿನ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮ ಪ್ರಾರ್ಥನೆಯ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಪ್ರಾರಂಭ ಶ್ರೀ ಪ್ರಾದೇಶ ಆಚಾರ್ಯ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರು ಅವರಿಂದ
ಆನಂದ ಮುಕುಂದ ಅರವಿಂದ ನಯನ ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥ ಪರಾನಂದ ವರದ ಆನಂದ ಮುಕುಂದ ಅರವಿಂದ ನಯನ ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥ ಪರಾನಂದ ವರದ ಸುಂದರಿ ಮಂದಿರ ಗೋವಿಂದ ಬಂದು ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥ ಪರಾನಂದ ವರದ ಸುಂದರಿ ಮಂದಿರ ಗೋವಿಂದ ಬಂದು ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥ ಪರಾನಂದ ವರದ ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥ ಪರಾನಂದ ವರದ ಚಂದ್ರಕ ಮಂದಿರ ನಂದಕ ಬಂದು ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥ ಪರಾನಂದ ವರದ ಚಂದ್ರಕ ಮಂದಿರ ನಂದಕ ಬಂದು ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥ ಪರಾನಂದ ವರದ ಚಂದ್ರ ಸುರೇಂದ್ರ ಸುವಂದಿತ ಬಂದು ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥ ಪರಾನಂದ ವರದ ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥ ಪರಾನಂದ ವರದ ಮಂದಾರ ಸ್ಯಂದಕ ಸ್ಯಂದನ ಬಂದು ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥ ಪರಾನಂದ ವರದ ಮಂದಾರ ಸ್ಯಂದಕ ಸ್ಯಂದನ ಬಂದು ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥ ಪರಾನಂದ ವರದ ವೃಂದಾರಕ ವೃಂದ ಸುವಂದಿತ ಬಂದು ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥ ಪರಾನಂದ ವರದ ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥ ಪರಾನಂದ ವರದ ಮಂದಾರ ಸಿಂಧಿತ ಮಂದಿರ ಬಂದು ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥ ಪರಾನಂದ ವರದ ಮಂದಾರ ಸಿಂಧಿತ ಮಂದಿರ ಬಂದು ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥ ಪರಾನಂದ ವರದ ಮಂದಿರ ಸ್ಯಂದನ ಸ್ಯಂದಕ ಬಂದು ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥ ಪರಾನಂದ ವರದ ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥ ಪರಾನಂದ ವರದ ಇಂದಿರಾನಂದಕ ಸುಂದರ ಬಂದೇ ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥ ಪರಾನಂದ ವರದ ಇಂದಿರಾನಂದಕ ಸುಂದರ ಬಂದೇ ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥ ಪರಾನಂದ ವರದ ಆನಂದ ಚಂದ್ರಿಕಾ ಸ್ಪಂದನ ಬಂದೇ ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥ ಪರಾನಂದ ವರದ ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥ ಪರಾನಂದ ವರದ ಆನಂದ ಮುಕುಂದ ಅರವಿಂದ ನಯನ ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥ ಪರಾನಂದ ವರದ ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥ ಪರಾನಂದ ವರದ ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥ ಪರಾನಂದ ವರದ
ಶ್ರೀಮದ್ ಆಚಾರ್ಯ ಮಧ್ವರು ಮೊಟ್ಟ ಮೊದಲು ಹರಿದಾಸ ಸಾಹಿತ್ಯಕ್ಕೆ ನಾಂದಿ ಹಾಕಿಕೊಟ್ಟಂತಹ ದ್ವಾದಶ ಸ್ತೋತ್ರ ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತ ರಚನೆ ಇದ್ದು ಇದನ್ನೇ ಕನ್ನಡೀಕರಿಸಿ ಶ್ರೀ ಬನಂಜಯ ಗೋವಿಂದ ಆಚಾರ್ಯರು ಕನ್ನಡದಲ್ಲಿ ಅನುವಾದವನ್ನು ಮಾಡಿಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಅದರ ಪ್ರಸ್ತುತಿ
ಓ ಸಂತಸದ ಸೆಲೆ ದುರ್ಗದೆಯೀವನು ಓ ಅರಳುದಾವರೆಯ ಕಂಗಣವನು ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥರಿಗೆ ತುಂಬು ಸಂತ ಸಗಂಬ ವರವಿತ್ತ ದೈವತವೇ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನು ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನು ಬಗೆಯ ಸುಂದರಿಯನ್ನು ಎದೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಹೊತ್ತವನು ಓವೋ ಗೋವಿಂದನೇ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನು ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥರಿಗೆ ತುಂಬು ಸಂತಸಗುವ ವರವಿತ್ತ ದೈವತವೇ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನು ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನು ಚಂದಿರನ ಹೊತ್ತಿರುವ ನವಿಲ ಸೋಗೆಯ ತೊಟ್ಟು ಜಗಕ್ಕೆ ಸಂತಸವೀವ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನ ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥರಿಗೆ ತುಂಬು ಸಂತಸವೆಂಬ ವರವಿತ್ತ ದೈವತವೇ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನ ಬಗೆಯ ಬೆಳಕುವ ಚಂದ್ರ ಸುರರನಾಳುವ ಇಂದ್ರ ಇವರಿಂದ ವಂದಿತನೇ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನ ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥರಿಗೆ ತುಂಬು ಸಂತಸವೆಂಬ ವರವಿತ್ತ ದೈವತವೇ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನ ದೇವಲೋಕದ ಎಲ್ಲ ಸಗ್ಗಿಗರ ಗಡನವು ಭಕ್ತಿಯಿಂದೆರಗುತಿಗ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನ ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥರಿಗೆ ತುಂಬು ಸಂತಸವೆಂಬ ವರವಿತ್ತ ದೈವತವೇ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನ ನಿನ್ನೆಡೆಗೆ ಹರಿದು ಬಹ ಸುರರೆಡೆಗೆ ಕಾರುಣ್ಯ ರಸವನ್ನು ಸುರಿಸುತಿಹ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನ ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥರಿಗೆ ತುಂಬು ಸಂತಸವೆಂಬ ವರವಿತ್ತ ದೈವತವೇ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನ ಇಂದಿರೆಯ ಬಗೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಸಂತಸವಾನುಕ್ಕಿಸುವ ಲೋಕೈಕ ಸುಂದರನೇ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನ ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥರಿಗೆ ತುಂಬು ಸಂತಸವೆಂಬ ವರವಿತ್ತ ದೈವತವೇ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನ ಮಂದಾರದರಳುಗಳು ಚಲ್ಲಿ ಪರಿಮಳಿಸುತ್ತೀಹ ಮಂದಿರದಲ್ಲಿರುವವನೇ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನ ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥರಿಗೆ ತುಂಬು ಸಂತಸವೆಂಬ ವರವಿತ್ತ ದೈವತವೇ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನ ಸಂತಸದ ಕೊನಲೆಂಬ ಚಲುವ ಬೆಳದಿಂಗಳನು ನಮ್ಮೆಡೆಗೆ ಹರಿಸುವ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನ ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥರಿಗೆ ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥರಿಗೆ ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥರಿಗೆ ತುಂಬು ಸಂತಸವೆಂಬ ವರವಿತ್ತ ದೈವತವೇ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನಂ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನಂ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನಂ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನಂ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನಂ ನಿನಗೆ ನಮನಂ
ತುಣುಕು ಯಕ್ಷಗಾನ ಪ್ರದರ್ಶನ ಮಣಿಪಾಲ ವಿಶ್ವವಿದ್ಯಾಲಯದ ಆಶ್ರಯದಲ್ಲಿರುವ ಯಕ್ಷಗಾನ ಕೇಂದ್ರ ಇಂದ್ರಾಳಿಯ ಯಕ್ಷಗಾನ ತಂಡದವರು ಯಕ್ಷಗಾನ ಗುರು ಶ್ರೀ ಸಂಜೀವ ಸುವರ್ಣರ ನಿರ್ದೇಶನದಲ್ಲಿ ರೂಪಿಸಲ್ಪಟ್ಟಿರುವ ಈ ಪ್ರದರ್ಶನವನ್ನು ನಮ್ಮ ಎದುರು ಮಂಡಿಸಲಿಕ್ಕಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಈ ಪ್ರದರ್ಶನದ ಶೀರ್ಷಿಕೆ ಜಟಾಯು ಮೋಕ್ಷ. ಸಾಮಾಜಿಕವೂ ಆಧ್ಯಾತ್ಮಿಕವೂ ಆದ ಸಂದೇಶವನ್ನು ಈ ಯಕ್ಷಗಾನ ಪ್ರದರ್ಶನ ನೀಡಲಿಕ್ಕಿದೆ. ಪ್ರದರ್ಶನದ ನಂತರ ಅದರ ಸಂದೇಶದ ಕುರಿತ ಒಂದೆರಡು ಮಾತುಗಳು ನಂತರ.
ಶಾಯ ಸರಸ್ವತ್ಯೈ ಪಾರ್ವತ್ಯೈ ಗುರವೇ ನಮಃ ದಕ್ಷಿಣಾಮೂರ್ತಿ ದೇವಾನಾಂ ಸಕಲ ಕಾರ್ಯ ವಿಜಯೀ ಭವ ಆ ವಸನವು ಕೈಯ ಜಪಸರ ಕೋವಿದಂಡಕ ಮಂಡಳುಗಳಿ ರಾವಣನು ಸನ್ಯಾಸಿ ವೇಷವ ತಾಳಿ ಬಂದ ಮಾರೀಚ ಬಂದ ಹೊನ್ನ ಬಣ್ಣದ ಮೃಗದ ರೂಪದಿ ಚನ ಚೆಲುವಿನ ಹೆಜ್ಜೆ ಗತಿಯಲಿ ಬಣ ಬೆಡಗಿನ ನೃತ್ಯದಲ್ಲಿ ಮಾರೀಚ ಬಂದ ಮಾರೀಚ ಬಂದ ದೀಮ್ ನಿನ್ನ ದಗ್ಗ ದಿನ ದೀಮ್ ನಿನ್ನ ದಗ್ಗ ದಿನ ದೀಮ್ ಮಾತ
ಶಂಕರನ ಪೀತೆಗೆ ಪರಿಯದೇ ಈ ಮೆರವ ದುರ್ಗಾಮೆಗೆ ಜಯ ಮಂಗಳಂ ನಿತ್ಯ ಶುಭ ಮಂಗಳಂ
ಮೌಲ್ಯಕ್ಕೆ ಭಂಗ ಬಂದಾಗ ಆ ಮೌಲ್ಯ ಭಂಗದ ವಿರುದ್ಧ ಸರ್ವರೀತಿಯಿಂದಲೂ ಪ್ರತಿಭಟನೆ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನೋದು ಈ ಪ್ರದರ್ಶನದ ಸಾಮಾಜಿಕ ಸಂದೇಶ. ಅದರ ಜೊತೆಗೇ ಉದಾತ್ತ ಜೀವನ ಧ್ಯೇಯಕ್ಕೋಸ್ಕರ, ಜೀವನ ಮೌಲ್ಯಕ್ಕೋಸ್ಕರ ನಮ್ಮ ಅಹಂನ ನಾಶವಾದರೂ, ನಮ್ಮ ಅಹಂನ ಮರಣವಾದರೂ ಕೂಡ ಅದು ಸ್ವೀಕಾರಾರ್ಹವೇ ಅನ್ನೋದು ಈ ಪ್ರದರ್ಶನದ ಆಧ್ಯಾತ್ಮಿಕ ಸಂದೇಶ. ಇಂದಿನ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮದ ವೇದಿಕೆಗೆ ಪರಮಪೂಜ್ಯ ಶ್ರೀ ಶ್ರೀ ಈಶಪ್ರಿಯ ತೀರ್ಥ ಶ್ರೀಪಾದರು ಮತ್ತು ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮದ ಮುಖ್ಯ ಅತಿಥಿಯಾಗಿರುವಂತಹ ಶ್ರೀ ಡಿ ಎ ಜೋಸೆಫ್ ಅವರು ಬರಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಅವರಲ್ಲಿ ವಿನಯಪೂರ್ವಕ ವಿನಂತಿ. ಹಿರಿಯರಾದ ಶ್ರೀ ಯು ಕೆ ರಾಘವೇಂದರ್ ರಾವ್ ಅವರು ಪೂಜ್ಯರನ್ನು ಮತ್ತು ಸನ್ಮಾನ್ಯ ಅತಿಥಿಗಳನ್ನು ವೇದಿಕೆಗೆ ಕರೆದುಕೊಂಡು ಬರಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಅವರಲ್ಲಿ ವಿನಂತಿ. ಶ್ರೀ ಇನ್ನ ಈಶ್ವರ ಮುಚ್ಚಿಂತಾಯ ಅವರು ಗೌರವ ಸಮರ್ಪಣೆಯನ್ನು ಮಾಡಿ ಅವರಿಗೆ ಈ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮಕ್ಕೆ ಹೃತ್ಪೂರ್ವಕವಾದ ಸ್ವಾಗತವನ್ನು ನೀಡಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ವಿನಂತಿ. ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮದ ವೇದಿಕೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಉಪಸ್ಥಿತರಿರುವ ಮಾನ್ಯರನ್ನು ಮತ್ತು ತಮ್ಮೆಲ್ಲರನ್ನು ಸ್ವಾಗತಿಸ್ತಾರೆ ಶ್ರೀ ಶ್ರೀನಿವಾಸ ಪೆಜತ್ತಾಯ ಅವರು.
ಕೃಷ್ಣಾಯ ವಾಸುದೇವಾಯ ಹರೇ ಪರಮಾತ್ಮನೇ, ಪ್ರಣದ ಕ್ಲೇಶ ನಾಶಾಯ ಗೋವಿಂದಾಯ ನಮೋ ನಮಃ. ವ್ಯಾಸಾಯ ಭವನಾಶಾಯ ಶ್ರೀಶಾಯ ಗುಣರಾಶಯ ಹೃದಯಾಯ ಶುದ್ಧ ವಿದ್ಯಾಯ ಮಧ್ವಾಯ ಚ ನಮೋ ನಮಃ. ಶ್ರೀಕೃಷ್ಣಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಆಲ್ ಮೈ ಶಾಷ್ಟಾಂಗ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರಂಸ್ ಟು ಈಶಪ್ರಿಯ ತೀರ್ಥ ಸ್ವಾಮೀಜಿ. ಆನ್ ಅ ಸ್ಪೆಷಲ್ ಡೇ ಏಕಾದಶಿ ಚಾತುರ್ಮಾಸ ವ್ರತ, ಸೊ ಸೀಕ್ ಯುವರ್ ಬ್ಲೆಸ್ಸಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ಟು ಮೂವ್ ಆನ್ ಹಿಯರ್. And then obviously we have some nice good Vaishnava Pandits also here, Srinivas Kalnur. So I want to take his blessings also, and I welcome all the Vaishnavas in the Sabha here. And I also want to welcome on behalf of Vishwarpana team, I want to welcome, we have the Purna Prajna Institution Management Secretaries, the Treasurers, the members, of course, the principals, the teachers, the students, the volunteers, organizers. So a warm welcome, heartily welcome on behalf of Vishwaparna team. Just to speak a little bit about the intention of Ishapriya Tirtha Swamiji's setting up this wonderful program. What is behind this program? This is to highlight the emergency situation of the deteriorating Hindu dharma and thereby awakening the community by these kinds of good dharmic and spiritual lectures, pravachana, music, whatsoever be it. We all call ourselves Hindus. We all call ourselves, we are Hindus, we follow Hindu dharma. But unfortunately, the truth is we really don't know the exact definition of dharma. Everyone has their own way of thinking what dharma is, but we have not studied the scriptures. We have our own feeling. When it comes to dharma, we think we know everything, but we call ourselves Hindu. But really, do we know what that is? So to get this awakening of what Hindu dharma is, Swamiji has created this forum where literally speakers will come and they talk and they give us the jnana of what is really needed and which is the ultimate goal of life. Today, when we talk about dharma, I'm really privileged and honored to welcome Sri D.A. Joseph. Not only for his vast academic achievements, but especially his interest in gaining the knowledge of Sanatana Dharma and spending over 3 decades giving that dharma back to the Hindi community. This is very special, unheard of. So please give him a hand. Thank you, sir. Welcome. Sri D.A. Joseph is a Roman Catholic by birth. However, he is deeply interested in Hinduism, especially in Vishishtadvaita philosophy. Living in Pondicherry, he delivers lectures on Hindu scriptures every day, every day. Besides, his academic interests are so diverse that Sri Joseph has studied and researched oriental sciences such as culture, indigenous medicine, and astropalmistry. In addition, he has a master's degree in English, Tamil, and Sanskrit. Amazing. Further, Sri Joseph has served as a professor of English at the Mathura University. Being a scholarly author, he has written the biographies of 12 Alvars. In the Tamil Nadu side, there is Alvars in the Sri Sampradaya, so he has written that as well. He has written many impactful articles in Tamil dailies and magazines. He has been a popular speaker on the Jaya TV, All India Radio, and Doordarshan. His lectures on diverse spiritual topics are popular throughout Tamil Nadu. Recently, Sri Joseph was also interviewed by the world-renowned scholar Sri Rajiv Malhotra, founder of the Infinity Foundation. Rishi Dharma, an organization founded by Sri D.A. Joseph, is meant for awakening the spiritual consciousness among the youth. I see a lot of youth today. Thank you very much for coming. Again, I would like to welcome D.A. Joseph, also called a mouthpiece for Indian ancient culture, to enlighten us on the topic of personality development. Vanakkam Thiru K.A. Joseph avargale, neenga inga vandirkeenga engalukku romba sandoshama irukke, neenga swami ji ku romba khushiya irukke, unga neenga enna pesringa nu naanga we are waiting. Thank you. Vanakkam.
I request Sri D.A. Joseph to take over to deliver his lecture on the topic personality development.
Swami ji gala padaravindigalige dasana saviniya namaskaragalu. Bhagavad kripaya labdham sadgurum yesam che tat kripa labdham jananna upakriti mahite bhagavati परमां भक्तिम आतुनुते. मूकं करोति वाचालं पंगुं लंगयते गिरिं यत्कृपा तमहं वंदे परमानंद माधवं. विथ माय हंबल थैंक्स टू दि ग्रेट पीपल हू स्पोक बिफोर मी इंट्रोड्यूसिंग मी एंड thanking you all for honoring me by your gesture of waiting eagerly to hear what I am going to talk. The topic given to me was personality development. It might sound like a psychiatric topic. Usually experts on psychology only deal with this topic. God's faith has nothing to do with that. They say religion has nothing to do with this topic. But I don't think so. As Swamiji and I discussed previously over phone, Indian acharas and anushtanas, our religious faith, they have very much to do with personality development. And I'm here to prove how they are interlinked. First of all, I would like to come to the definition of the term personality development. What do we mean by personality? That word is derived from the basic word person. What is a person? What does it mean? We don't call a dog a person. We don't call a cat a person. Only human beings are called persons. Why? Because personage means the basic need for a soul under the 6 senses. Only him we call a person. We say vyaktitva, that is a person's individuality outcome. If I would try to explain to you what personality development is, perhaps it might bore you. I would like to be simpler. How to differentiate a man who has sufficient personality development from a man who has underdeveloped personality? If I can explain that, I think you will understand what personality development is. I think I can bring before you some 12 major points, some 12 symptoms which would help you identify a developed personality. How to find out a developed personality? Number one, a developed personality will not hesitate to address a huge audience standing on a stage. You invite a man who does not have a developed personality to address an audience, to stand before a stage, he would say no. He won't come. But a person with this developed personality will readily accept it, because his personality has come out to the stage of teaching others something what he has learned. Learning is not great. You must be able to teach it to others. Only then your personality is complete. Second one is, a developed personality will never go for slavery job. You know, in modern days, unemployment is a very serious problem. Every graduate complains, I get no job. I have walked over the thresholds of hundreds of business concerns, no job, no vacancy. But a developed personality will have the guts enough to start up his own business or his own profession so that he can give employment to others. Thirdly, developed personality easily becomes a leader. He can lead over others, at least for 10 people, or 20, or 50, or 100, or 1,000. If you read the biographies of world leaders, we find out that they were in their adolescent days, capable leaders. Take Adolf Hitler, Subhas Chandra Bose, Jawaharlal Nehru. These people, while they were yet students, could lead people. That leadership will be inborn in them. Then comes the spiritual power, the fourth symptom, spiritual power. Spiritual power comes to a man only when he believes that spirituality can bestow upon him powers. You must have so much of faith in spirituality that getting powers and displaying it to others is possible for him. That is where we lag behind. When some God-man performs some miracle, we prefer to go to him, touch his feet, and demand for some miracle for our personal benefit. But we don't go to the extent of asking ourselves, why can't I become a miracle performer? If spirituality is true, why should I not try it? That self-confidence only a man of developed personality will get. The other one won't get. Then the fifth one, self-reliance. A man with a developed personality will rely on himself. He would not very much expect the support of others. He would like to stand on his own leg even for small things. Say even for taking a tumbler of water from there, this man would go himself and take it. He won't fetch others to do it. That is one symptom. Then these people become famous easily. Fame does not necessarily mean international. It might get limited to one street, or one village, or one district, or one province. But necessarily these people become famous very easily. Then the seventh symptom is, they can offer support to others. They will be capable of supporting others. They can not only support themselves, but also support others. I shall give you an example. A double degree holder, he tried an opportunity for employment in many places. He could not get anything. Then he thought about making money. He found out that on NH national highways, when cars and vehicles go, they stop them and collect tax, road tax. Sometimes when three or four vehicles are blocked that way, it takes some 5 minutes before it gets cleared off. So he cooked up an idea. He boiled these groundnuts, kadlekai, boiled these groundnuts, made into small packets, fixed a price, and then when all those vehicles are stopping there, he will rush in, peep through the window, try to push this in. Sir, please get this. Very tasty, very cheap. He would also do another thing. He would have a contract between the tax collector. He would tip him some money. Please don't allow the vehicles faster. Please delay for a few minutes. Within which he would sell it. This way he started, and you know what happened? He could make 8,000 rupees per day. Now it is going on. It's reality. So this idea of original self-supporting, now he has given employment to some 10 people, has become a businessman, a business magnet. Then self-confidence. You know, among the college students we find a trend. They buy magazines, psychological magazines, which boost courage and self-confidence in young students. And those magazines write, believe in yourself, you can do it. Like that they write articles. But these people find that they can give courage to others. Then the ninth symptom is they can develop talents, singing, acting, writing, or becoming a poet. Such talents come to them easily by self-efforts, by some upasanas. And we find that people of great talents were not that much talented in their early days. They tried, then they shot up. Then comes the 10th point. You see, actually, each point I have to explain for 5 minutes at least. But the time given to me is very short, so I am rushing through. Then the 10th one is, he knows more than one language. People of developed personality, they somehow manage to learn more than one language. See, normally speaking, even auto rickshaw drivers you can find talking 4 or 5 languages. Those auto rickshaw drivers, they own some 10 auto rickshaws. They are boss. So learning languages is a craze for them, is a taste for them. Then these people can aspire for the seventh sense. We know about 6 senses. The 6th sense is the brain, human brain. There is the 7th sense, that is the mystic power, what yogis have. These people can very easily try for it and attain it. Vivekananda had a desire for it, and he could attain it to a certain extent. Then, the last point, they can easily bear with the practical difficulties of life. When they are faced with financial difficulties or family difficulties or whatever it may be, they face it boldly and solve them. So these 12 symptoms will betray to you that they are people of developed personalities. Now I have explained to you how to identify them. And there is one more biological way of identifying a developed personality. What is that? There is a shastra called the Shariraka Shastra in Sanskrit. It belongs to the Kartikeyan school of thought, written by our sages. That says, that gives us a sloka, and that sloka is as follows. That sage starts describing human phrenology. Have you heard of phrenology? Phrenology is a subject by which you can judge the fortune of a man on basis of his face, nose, eyes, ears. We call it as Samudrika Shastra in Sanskrit. It's called phrenology. While he is speaking of phrenology, he says, Mukhyam tu urdhvam sarirasya tatrani mukham uchyate tatrapi nasika sreshta sreshte chakshushi sarvam sattve pratishtitam. In human body, the upper part is more important than the lower part, that is above your waist. In the above part, face is more important than the remaining limbs. In the face, tatrapi nasika sreshta, the nose must be well formed. More than nose, sreshte chakshushi, the eyes are more revealing his fortune. Why? Sarvam sattve pratishtitam. A man's success in life depends upon his courage. A man's courage is very easily revealed through his eyes. When you look into the eyes of a man, you can make out whether he is a man of guts or not. He will be capable of looking through your eyes. His eyes will be bright. If you want an example, I can quote Subhash Chandra Bose or Vivekananda. Have you watched their photos? Their eyes will be very bright. That indicates that he is a man of developed personality. He can do great things. Now, does Lord Krishna say anything about this personality development? Yes, he does. Where? 6th chapter, 5th sloka. What does it say? Udhret atmana atmanam na atmanam avasadet atmaivahi atmano banduhu atmaivaripur atmanaha. A man must uplift himself by his own efforts. Nobody else will come and help you. Nobody is going to help you, lend a helping hand to come up. You are responsible for that, because you are your own enemy, you are your own friend. What a wonderful sloka. I think I can write volumes of book on this one sloka. I would also like to say that the whole Bhagavad Gita is a book on personality development. Why? How? Arjuna is funked. He has become a coward. Klaibhyam Asmagama, Krishna says, he became a coward. He said, no, I won't fight. So his personality has gone down. Now Lord Krishna starts Bhagavad Gita and lifts up his personality. Towards the end of Bhagavad Gita, in the chapter 18, sloka number 66, we find Arjuna totally agreeing with Krishna. He is ready to do what he is commanding. He says, Sarva dharman parityajya mamekam charanam braja aham tva sarva papebhyo moksha ishami masucha. I have been teaching you bhakti yoga, karma yoga, all those yogas, but they are not that much reliable. You surrender yourself to me, I would help you, I would remove your sins, I would give you salvation. And thereby letting out that secret, he showed us a very great and easy route for the people of Kali Yuga. You know, when this happened, in the Yuga before Kali Yuga, this happened. Almost that Yuga was over, Dwapara Yuga was over. This Bhagavad Gita was meant to be a book for people like us. So Ramanuja took this Prapati Shastra from this. Madhvacharya also took this concept of surrender from that sloka, this Charama sloka. It's a personality development. You can keep aside the religious element very safely and follow that Bhagavad Gita as a personality development book. And he says, the food you eat daily, it has great amount of responsibility for your character. If you go to chapter 17 deals with food. The food you consume decides who you are going to be. And there he classifies man into three categories, the sattvic, the rajasic, and tamasic. This classification no other religion has done in the world. In no other book you can find this classification. And another individuality of Bhagavad Gita is, the books of other religions say that this is wrong, don't do it. But no book tells you how to avoid it. Other religions say don't steal, don't lie, don't wish for another's property, don't be lusty. Okay, wonderful preaching. But how to do it? I'm not able to. I want to do it. I am trying for it, but I'm not able to succeed. My mind fails me. When you ask that question, what do they say? Simply pray to God. That is the only answer, static answer they have. But Krishna goes one step ahead and he says, hey, the helping guide is in the daily food you consume, man. The idli you eat, the rice you eat, the coffee you drink, the chapati you eat. They decide who you are going to be. They are deeply connected with your qualities and character. By controlling that food, you can become a better man. So avoid these kinds of food. Accept these kinds of food. This advice only Krishna gives. And there lies the secret of personality development. No psychologist in the world has gone to the extent of saying that your food has connection with your personality. But Krishna says that. Then, coming to the next point, Upanishads. Upanishads give you a command. Go to Kathopanishad. What does it say? Uttishtata, Jagrata, Prapya Varan, Nibodhata. Arise, awake. That is, bring up your personality. Your personality can grow like a butterfly from the stage of caterpillar. You see how butterfly evolves into butterfly by stages. Similarly, your soul, your mental personality is a growing butterfly. Uttishtata, arise, awake. Come on, wake up, man, don't be sleeping. Okay, what should I do? Prapya Varan, go to learned people. Approach people who are well informed. Prapya Varan Nibodhata, get knowledge from them. Get wisdom from them. Rishis have written them. Indian rishis have given us the secret code for a good healthy life, for a developed mentality, everything. And now I'm coming back to this acharas and anushtanas. The word achara comes from the word chara. Chara means live, behave. In every code of behavior, your personality development is connected. And you would be surprised to know that they said your personality resides in everything you see, in time, in objects, in food, in directions, in behavior, in habits, in everything. They say while sleeping, keep your head on the east side. When our grandmother asks us to do it, we get irritated. You old woman, shut up. Science has taught us that all directions are equal. What is the point in keeping the head in the east? She says, keeping your head in the east while sleeping develops your memory power because it is the sun's, the rising sun's direction. It has some effect upon it. We won't believe. Similarly, while you want to have a shave, don't shave facing eastward. You will be losing your longevity because it is an auspicious direction. Then while eating food, avoid these foods like garlic, onion, old food, toddy. These things, they make you sluggish. They make you lose your memory power. So in food they saw personality development. In directions they saw personality development. In everything, even while taking bath, you know what these young people do while taking bath? They start singing songs. What songs? Not devotional, all cine songs. They feel so happy while hot water or cold water is poured on their head. Their spirits are very high. They sing so loudly that in the kitchen the lady is not able to cook. Hey, stop the donkey's wise man. But actually, Shastras say while taking bath, remember it is not a bath, it is an Abhisheka. The body is a temple, deities reside in each and every limb. In the eyes, we find the sun. In the ears, we find the Dig Devata. Like that, every limb has a superseding deity. So while you are pouring water, you must think of that mantra, worship that deity. If you do so, Sri Bhagavata gives us a proper description of that. If you do so, you will never get diseases. Very easy way of avoiding diseases. While you think that this human body is a temple of God and gods, and if you treat it that way every day, you will live for more than 100 years. You know, our ancestors, our grandfather, great-grandfather, those people never wore these spectacles. When I wore a spectacle while I was a student of 5th standard, my great-grandfather called me, "You idiot. You are not living properly, and so you have come to the stage of wearing a spectacle to see." You see, I am 105 now. I am able to see very sharply.
5 minutes.
Okay. So, those people were healthier. Their ears were very sharp. Even now, we have sharp ears. Hearing aid has not become that popular. But after 50 years, I think everyone will be wearing a hearing aid. Degeneration. Just as most of us are wearing spectacles. So, in taking bath, there is personality development. Then behavior. Say, your attitude to your father, your mother, your teachers, your guru. I published a video. The title is Become Rich in 10 Minutes. Become Rich in 10 Minutes. If you go to my YouTube section, dajoseph.com, you search for this video. In that, I had said, you know, the title is very alluring, you know. Everyone clicked it. Become Rich in 10 Minutes. How? How? So each one started seeing that. In that I have said, you worship Lord Narayana in the physical form of your father, your mother, your teachers, and your guru. Because the Shastras say, Pitru Devo Bhava, Matru Devo Bhava, Atithi Devo Bhava, Acharyo Devo Bhava. If you think like that, if you do it, that will pave way for a better life very soon. I have said that. This is a short lecture. And you won't believe me, almost 1 lakh views are registered there, and very many people phoned up to me. They said, a Negro phones up to me, "Sir, I practiced your package. I am successful. My business is picked up." A Negro is saying that. So that's where we find acharas give you this good fortune also. Then, I am asked to finish my talk within a few minutes. I'll do it. Then this satsanga. Satsanga is association with the good people. When you find yourself in the company of good people, noble people, learned people, you experience a sort of a radiation, an unknown radiation, unidentifiable radiation. Those rays come and purify your soul. And that aura is not noticeable for naked eyes, but great people will be able to identify that. So you find yourself in the company of people like this. Now we are assembled here, not minding the dark pour of rain. We are sitting here. And I don't know how far this meeting is going to be, but after this is over, you can be sure that everyone has enriched his soul and mental power to certain extent. And thereby, we find a personality coming up. In Vishnu Purana, there is a story. A king completed a yaga, yajna, and for avaprata snana, he goes to Ganges. While he is about to step down into the river, he comes across his school days friend. That friend says, "Hi, how are you, man?" He also answers him. That fellow, that friend happens to be an atheist. He doesn't believe in God. He doesn't believe in acharas. He doesn't go to temples like that. So what happens is, this king, just because he spoke with a man of that type of a character, he was born as a dog. You see, he performed a yajna, a yaga, but the result, he became a dog. And a rishi tells the wife of this king, "Look here, lady, this dog is none but your own husband. Your husband is born as a dog, treat him respectfully. You work for his emancipation." And Vishnu Purana says, just because his association was with an atheist, he was born as a dog. So satsanga helps us unknowingly. There is no thermometer to show you how much we have improved. And we read great histories. I would make a reference to sage Vidyaranya. Vidyaranya was responsible for the establishment of Vijayanagara Samrajya. This Vidyaranya was praying to God that this domination of other religions, at that time India was under the grip of Mohammedans, it must cease, Hinduism must come up. And he got a dream that two men will come to him, and because of them it will be possible. He was waiting eagerly, and two young men came. One is Harihara and the other one is Bukka. Hariharaya, Bukkaraya. These two people, they came to him, promised him that they will help establish this Hindu Samrajya. But what they need is money. Without empower, we cannot do that. I need money, they said. You know what Vidyaranya said? After all, you want money. After all, you want money, I'll give you. Now, Harihara and Bukka laughed. "Swamiji, you are mistaken. I am not asking for a handful of money. I am asking for money so high, mountain high. Only then I can establish Hindu Samrajya. To maintain an army is not lay. It's not a small thing. You know, Indian army is the second biggest military in the world. And so many lakhs and crores of rupees are spent upon it every year." Then this sage Vidyaranya sang this Samputita Sri Sukta, and gold poured like rain. And with that, Vijayanagara Samrajya was established in Hampi. And you know how for 200 years, we were free of any foreign invasion. It's a personality development. This Harihara and Bukka, they wanted to do this, but they could not because their personalities were not ripe enough. And sage Vidyaranya helped. And these developed personalities are of three kinds, about whom I would explain later on the next occasion. They are Jovian personalities, Martian personalities, Venusian personalities. I will describe them later. And I will be keeping on talking like this endlessly. I don't know whether you will keep listening endlessly. So with this, I stop inviting the questions from you so that I can answer them. Thank you.
Rituals, Puranas and belief systems, philosophy and mysticism. Thus, we will try to cover a plethora of dimensions of life. We will also get opportunity to ask questions, but for the sake of the order and decorum of the program, one who compares a program will ask him questions on your behalf. I request those who want to ask questions to write their questions in one or two sentences, straightforward questions, and also write your name. We will
announce your names while we ask your questions to Sri D.A. Joseph. Pranams to Swamiji. I seek Swamiji's permission to start this interaction. Yesterday, an interesting article was published by Udayavani. The moment I read the title of the article, I felt, of course, I have to read the article, but it summed up the entire essence of the article. The title of the article read, Joseph Iyengar is coming to Udupi. So let me start with this particular curious name itself. We have heard of David Frawley, who is a great Vedic scholar and also Padma Bhushan awardee. He is the one who is the vocal proponent of Hindu culture. He has converted himself, rather embraced Hinduism, has called himself Vamadev Shastri, but has kept the name David Frawley. What is this curious combination of Joseph and Iyengar?
I have had a tough journey in my path of quest for knowledge and wisdom. And during that journey, I had very bitter experiences. I was very much discouraged by people not to come to this path. But in spite of that, Lord made my path successful. And once it so happened that I was invited to speak on the occasion of this Samprokshana, Kumbhabhishekam of Lord Parthasarathi temple in Trivallikeni, Chennai. On that occasion, the pontiff, the GR of Sri Perumbudur also had come there, and we had to stay in the same place. The whole night was spent in discussions. He was talking to me, was inquisitive about my past, present and future plans. He felt impressed and said, actually you are a true Iyengar, though you are born in a Christian family, you are the true Iyengar. I don't see these Iyengars who call themselves Iyengars or not are that much true. So I would declare on the stage that you must be called as Joseph Iyengar. And he did so. On one occasion, when I ended my speech, many people applauded like you here, and the GR, he got the mic from me. He said, I have a way of applauding his speech. I confer upon him today a title as D.A. Joseph Iyengar. So I expect you people, my disciples, to call him as Joseph Iyengar. Please continue doing so, he said. That is the secret.
Having listened to the speeches of Swami Vivekananda in the West, many people commented that it's a big mockery that we send missionaries to India for conversion activity. In fact, even now, even after one century of such scholarly comment on the stuff of Indian culture, conversions are a big investment activity in our country. Why is it that you embraced Hinduism? I don't want to use the word you converted to Hinduism, but why is it that you embraced Hinduism? What is that, being a Roman Catholic, that you found something which is special and unique in Hinduism?
You know, one thing very individualistic about these Christian pastors is, they claim that theirs is the only correct religion. They worship the only right deity. They claim that their worship is the only right one, and all other forms of worship are wrong and bad. This is how we were taught in our infancy. And my fellow beings, they could accept it and digest it, but I could not. I felt that, you know, my Hindu friends, I was a student of a Christian school, St. Mary's High School in Madurai. My Hindu friends, I could see them to be very good, very generous, very forgiving, very liberal, very peace-loving, you know. Now, my question is, if what you say is right, that your religion is the only correct religion, and all other religions are wrong religions, these boys must not be good. They must be evil-minded. They must do all kinds of bad things, but they don't do it. They seem to be very good. That means their religion teaches them to do good things. Is it not so? Then when a wrong religion teaches its believers to do good things, it is a contrast, it is a contradiction. How are you going to pacify this? I asked those priests, and they said, while moving with people of other faiths, be very careful. The best thing to do is don't move with them. You restrict your friendship only with people of our faith. Don't move with them. They will get you confused like this. This was the only answer they gave. They could not answer my question. Fortunately or unfortunately, this increased my curiosity. I thought, you know, always the forbidden fruit is sweet. If you say don't eat it, everybody will be tempted to eat that. If you tell a boy don't go there, he will be tempted to go there. So when they said don't move with the Hindus, I had a temptation to move with them. Let me move with them, let me find out what is wrong. So my friendship with people of other religions increased, and I felt within myself that there is some good thing in other religions also. What is that one bad thing these priests taught us was the deity they are worshipping is devil. It is not God. That is the repeated teaching they gave us. So what now my question is, what is the definition of devil? How will a devil be like? If you call a man a devil, you must be able to explain how you are right. Then for that question they could not answer. They said it is written in our book that only our deity is God. All other deities are devils. Don't go and move with them. So it launched me in a disastrous pursuit for truth. I became very thirsty in knowing about other religions. I moved with the scholars of all religions. And ultimately, I found out that a few questions which I had in my mind about the preachings of the pastors could not be answered satisfactorily. But there was a satisfactory answer for those questions in other religions, to a certain extent at least. So when I could pacify myself with the answers they gave me, I became more and more devoted to those religions. And when I realized that the Sri Vaishnavism of Sri Ramanuja pacified me completely, when that pacified my thirst completely, I found a true Godhead in the reflection of Lord Krishna and one Sri Viraraghava Iyengar. He was the man who taught to me Vishishtadvaita, Sanskrit, Tamil, Sankhya philosophy, all the Shaddarshans. I learned from him Jainism, Buddhism, and he was a deep scholar in Tamil literature also. He was a multi-sided genius. But it was God's will that his name must not come out famously. And that's why I'm spreading his name now. He deserves more than this. Then that is how I came to this fold. And perhaps their selfish assertion that their way is the only correct one was the cause for my this hunt, spiritual hunt.
Already I have received some questions. Yes. I have been receiving them.
Go ahead.
So I put aside the list of my questions. Let us cater to their questions. Here I find one interesting question. Aharadinda Vyaktitva Nirmana Embodu Avaijnanika Annisodilve. Don't you feel that it is unscientific to articulate that food decides
the development of personality. Mamsahara, sasyahara, yeradannu tulane martta iddira. Are you comparing both vegetarian food and non-vegetarian food while you make this assertion? Ayurveda drishtiyinda mamsaharavu sasyaharavu samavagide. Ahara shastra drishtiyinda ee bheda sariye. From the point of view of Ayurveda, both vegetarian and non-vegetarian food are equal in their effect. From the point of view of nutrition, science of nutrition, is this discrimination between the type of food justified? Sri J.P. Prabhakar has asked this interesting question.
Now, this is not a question of Mr. Prabhakar alone. Almost everyone asks this question. You know, food is of two kinds. One, food that is good for health. Two, food good for spirituality. For example, if you consume cold rice, that is, you cook rice the previous day, you pour water in it, allow it to soak for the whole night, the next day it's called cold rice, halaya anna. That is good for health. Ayurvedic doctors say it is good for health. But our spiritual doctors, our rishis, have found out from practical life that anything which is old, that is in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, yatayamam. Yatayamam means any food which is as old as 20 minutes. If a food becomes 20 minutes old, it is bad food. Bad food not from the nourishment point of view. It is from the spiritual point of view. It has been proved by practical life. You know, down the ages they have tried several kinds of food and found out as a result that spiritually it affects. It is not something which can be proved immediately. Now some person will say, here is non-veg food, I will eat this now. Do you say that immediately I will become a violent fellow? I can prove you that I continue to be a man of ahimsa. No, such instant tests are not reliable as far as spiritual test is concerned. Down the ages by experience, I can make you understand this way. You know, military people, people who are working in the military, army, they like hot chilies very much. Basically, all military people, militant people like only chilies, more of chili in their food. And Bhagavad Gita says, if you add more and more chili in your food, you lose your temper very soon. And you can find in real life that military men are short-tempered. They are prone to take pistol immediately. They'll shoot. Because they've been taught like that, shoot to kill. That is the only thing they know. So even hotels are named like that, military hotel. I don't know how a hotel can become a military. Because there is too much of chilies in the food, they call it a military, and non-veg food is given there, they call it military. So they have understood that non-veg food and chilies make a man military. What is the meaning of military? Resorting to violence, isn't it? If you slap a man, a vegetarian, slap him on the cheek, he'll say, hey, why did you hit me, man? Don't do it again, I'll be very serious. This is how he'll react. You go and slap a military soldier on the cheek, he won't talk. He will immediately box you in the face so hardly, you will lose four teeth. First he will box, then he will ask you, why did you hit me, man? That short-tempered nature is due to the food he consumes. That has been proved practically. So this findings of doctors is not that reliable. And in the West, Prabhupada went and preached Hare Rama, Hare Krishna movement. The first thing he taught was give up liquor, give up non-veg. And he faced the same question there. Every white man asked him, how can liquor affect a man's discipline? How can meat affect a man's discipline? Then you know what he said, you be a vegetarian continuously for 60 days. On the 61st day, you lie down on the bed, think calmly, ask yourself, am I the same man as I was before 60 days? You would realize that you can very easily control your urges, your temperament now. So, if 60 days of vegetarian diet can bring about such a huge change, how about a lifelong vegetarian diet? That is what our rishis found out. They said, don't eat this. They won't be giving you practical proof like this, because it is not their duty also. And in practical life, we can find a man who eats sattvic food is always sattvic in his speech, in his way of life, in his choice of bride, in everything for that matter. I have seen. In Pondicherry, there is this Aurobindo ashram. In that Aurobindo ashram, they serve you only sattvic food. But one lunch costs you only 2 rupees. You can't get lunch for 2 rupees anywhere in the world. But there in ashram, they give food for 2 rupees. You know what these ashram people do? They buy that food for 2 rupees and sell it for 10 rupees outside. Because they want only rajasic food. They won't eat this food. I know a few ashramites like that. Not all ashramites are doing that. A few ashramites are doing that. I know personally. And people who stick on to this sattvic food, they are very calm, they are very quiet, even provoked, they don't lose temper that much. And another thing, you know, I will tell you one thing. You go to the criminal jail. You know, there is a civil jail and a criminal jail. Criminal jail contains prisoners who commit violent offenses like stabbing, killing and such things. Civil jail doesn't have such prisoners. That is cheating money only or a quarrel about land or property. If you go to a criminal jail and meet the warden, jail warden, sir, can you answer me this question? Of these prisoners, how many are vegetarians? You ask him. I have asked twice. Two jail wardens I have asked. You know what answer he gave? 10% they are non-vegetarians. Non-vegetarians come to criminal jail very easily. I won't say that all non-vegetarians are criminals, but all criminals are non-vegetarians. The vice versa is true. I don't know why. And that is the answer for your question. Bhagavad Gita is explained there in jails, criminal jails. So do you want to go to criminal jail, Mr. Prabhakar? I don't think so. The next question.
Sri V.N. Puranik has asked an interesting question. He says Vivekananda died before 35 years to set right the fact. He died a few months after he went past 39 years. But that apart, the question is here. Did he not know the principle Sharira Madhyam Khalu Dharma Sadhanam? Because he experienced an early death.
The last part of the question.
Did he not know the principle Sharira Madhyam Khalu Dharma Sadhanam?
I know.
He had an early death, but did he not know the importance of Sharira?
Okay. If you have read the biography of Vivekananda, like me, thoroughly, the answer is there. While Ramakrishna was alive, he was watching Vivekananda while sleeping. The next day, he called Vivekananda, "Hey, Naren, come here, man. I watched you last night while you were sleeping. You breathed very fastly. Such people will die soon. So, why don't you take up some breathing exercise and increase your longevity?" But Vivekananda said, "I am happy with the duration of life God has given. If He wants to take me tomorrow, I am ready." So that was his attitude. Now, yoga says breathing must be steady and slow. You can check yourself today. You go home while you are about to sleep. You observe your chest while breathing. If you are breathing very slowly. You must inhale breath like that. Then you must let it out slowly. It must come automatically, not by artificial effort. If you breathe like that, it means you will live long. I have seen people who breathe very fast like a dog. You know, this dog runs very fast in the road. If you stop it and watch, the dog will breathe like that. This fast breathing means there is no longevity. Vivekananda, while being born, was destined by God to die a premature death. That was his destiny, and he was not ready to elongate his longevity. He didn't want to. That is the answer.
Here is an interesting question. The question doesn't have the name written on it, but still the question is challenging. There are atheists who do good and there are religious people who do bad deeds. So is it right to confine your friendship on the basis of belief in God or religions?
You know, belief in God is not sufficient. If your belief in God is sufficiently strong, you would live a godly life. If it is only narrow, if it is theoretical, you will do bad things. That is, it is like merchants who do adulteration. I know a man who, you know, that man was living next to my neighborhood in Madurai. At night time, by 12 o'clock, you can hear the noise of a bullock cart coming and stopping before his house. You know, bags so tall, some 10 bags or 15 bags will arrive. They will be led to the inside of the house. Those bags will contain small white stones resembling rice. They look exactly like rice, but they are stones. This man will take those stones and mingle with real rice, pure rice. Thus he will make one bag into two bags. And he used to sell that rice, that adulterated rice. And he became a rich man. But this man had a habit. You know, on the day of Kartikai Deepa in Trivannamalai, you know, upon the hill, the flames go high. This man will go buy camphor for 10,000 rupees and drop it there. And he will pray to God, "Oh Lord, may all my adulteration sins be burnt with this camphor." And he kept repeating this for decades. And what happened? One child died prematurely. One girl got married and she was tortured by her husband. She committed suicide. And his life was a tragedy. All the properties he earned could not satisfy his ambitions. So doing bad and believing God, they are not two parallel things. If your faith is strong enough, you won't do bad things. That's it. Then, some people say, people who do not believe in God get good things in life. People who believe in God, they suffer. For that, you know, I will repeat to you an old story narrated by my grandfather. There were two friends, one was a believer and one was a non-believer. They were close chums. While they walked along the road, there was a temple, Vishnu temple. The believer said, "Hey, stay outside, man, you are a non-believer. I would go to the temple, offer my worship and come out." So this fellow was waiting out. This man went in. He offered worship to Lord Vishnu. He came out. Then both the fellows resumed the journey. And it so happened there was a stone. The believer did not observe. He stumbled on the stone. So he fell. While falling, there was a long stick of thorns. And he wanted to support his body by his hand palm. He rested on the thorns and the thorns went deep into his palm. He started bleeding. He could not get up, So he held the hand of the standing friend. With his strength, he tried to get up. He pulled him down and he tried to get up. Unable to bear with that pressure, that fellow fell down. When he fell down, in the place where he fell down, where his palm touched the earth, there was a 10 rupees currency note. He took it. Now both of them got up. Now the non-believer asked the believer, "Hey man, you went and worshipped God. What happened? You fell down. Now thorns went deep in, you are bleeding. Whereas I did not believe in God, I did not worship, I got 10 rupees. From this you must understand that believing is idiocy. Don't go to temples hereafter." Now the believer could not answer this question because it was a practical proof. Practically he has proved that not believing yields you good things. So he was moved out. He became silent. He was almost in tears. Both were walking silently for a few yards. And under a banyan tree, there was a sage sitting. He was chanting mantras. These two fellows passed that sage and crossed him. This non-believer said, "These lazy idiots have no other work to do, man. At least you worship God and start doing other works. These fellows waste their life chanting mantras." The man, the sage who was keeping his eyes shut, he opened his eyes. "Hey boy, come here, man. What did you say? I'm a lazy idiot, huh? That's good. Now, your question is, the believer got wounded, non-believer got money. Is that not so?" "Yes, sir." And he said, "As per the previous karma, that believer was to lose his hand by a traffic accident. A chariot was about to go upon his hand and he was about to lose the hand. But because he went to Vishnu's temple and prayed, Vishnu cut short the karma. He reduced it to just a thorn pricking. Now according to your karma, you were to take a pot full of gold coins today. But because you didn't go to the temple, you made fun of that fellow, the Lord cut short his punya karma. He reduced it to 10 rupees. That is the fact. So you won't ask such questions hereafter like this. You know? So this story was told by my grandfather. He said, "So even if good things don't happen in your life, don't stop worshipping. Even if you get difficulties in life, don't stop worshipping. Be steady in your faith." And this story, though very short and small, taught me such a strong moral that it strengthened my faith. I think I explained.
Here is a related question. A monk of a prominent Hindu organization once told me about an interesting comment made by a priest of a non-Hindu religion. The comment was this: in Hinduism, there are very less practicing Hindus. This comment made by that priest of the non-Hindu religion stirred the emotions and the thoughts of this monk of the Hindu organization. Now I want to ask, against the background of this comment, what do we mean by becoming practicing Hindus? What is it that it makes us Hindus? Is it that by birth alone do we really become Hindus, or should we do something more? If at all we have to do something more, should we immerse ourselves in religious rituals? Rituals have their meaning, at the same time they have their limit. Therefore, what makes us practicing Hindus? What is the limit of rituals? Spirituality may not be the calling of everyone. Therefore, should we say that only those who are spiritual are really Hindus? So how do we resolve this dichotomy and dilemma of defining a practicing Hindu?
No, basically there is a difference between Hinduism and other religions. Other religions give you a code of living. Say, the Christianity I was born in. It taught me, you must go to church once a week. Every Sunday you must be there. And you must follow the Ten Commandments. You must be kind-hearted to others. Don't harm to anybody. This was the basic teaching. Almost all religions preach like this only. They don't go beyond this. So this is the practice of religion for them. Whereas Hinduism, it has several stages of preaching. Who is a Hindu? If you ask that question, the answer will not be in one line. Whereas if you ask who is, fill up the blanks with other religion's name, you can put it very easily. In Hinduism, the main preaching is there are several stages of life. According to karma theory, each soul has its own different past. There will be four sons for the same mother. One son would have traveled very far distance in karma theory. Another son will not have traveled that far distance in karma theory. One son will be a murderer, one son will become a monk. Just because they are brothers, you cannot expect the same result from them. Hinduism has something to offer, something to everybody, even to a murderer, even to a man of vengeance. Hinduism has something to do. So in Hinduism we find several cadres of faith. The man who has renounced completely, the man who is a yogi, the man who is a sannyasi, the man who is a preacher, they come to the higher cadre. Now we come to the middle cadre, a man who goes to office daily, who won't steal very much, who won't lie very much, but he will go to temple, he will take part in functions. According to him, Hinduism is being good, that's all. Then the third category, he will worship petty deities, village deities, and he worships them for the sake of taking vengeance against his enemies. He worships some Grama Devata. He tells the deity, I am going to cut the head of my enemy today. My prayer to you is, I must not get caught. I must do it successfully. If this is done by me successfully, I will sacrifice a goat for you, a big goat, coming Friday. And that is a promise. Now he goes, he kills his enemy, the police chases him, he escapes somehow, he is grateful to that deity, he comes with a goat and sacrifices it. Now he is also a Hindu. Now look at the difference of grades in one religion. Lord Krishna speaks about it in Bhagavad Gita. He says, Tamasic devotee, Rajasic devotee, Sattvic devotee. There are three kinds of devotees. Okay, leave alone Tamasic deities and worshippers of other deities. Take the case of my own devotees. Four kinds of devotees come and worship me. They are different from each other in so many ways. One man worships me for getting the first lottery prize. One man worships me for getting a film chance in Kodambakam, in Madras. One man worships me for getting spiritual knowledge. One man worships me for attaining moksha. Chaturvidam, you see, four kinds of devotees are there. All these four kinds of devotees are dear to me, he says. Even if you worship me for the sake of money only, I like you. Why? Because for this sake you did not go to other deities. You came to me. Well then, you have come to me, I won't leave you. I will give you money, I will strengthen your faith, I will make you come again and again to me. Gradually I will make you a wise man. I will make you a sannyasi. I know how to do it. That is what Krishna says. So now, how would you define a Hindu? who is a Hindu? Would you define that a Hindu is a man who cuts the head of his enemy and sacrifices a goat to his Gramadevata? Would you say that? Or would you say that a man who worships Lord Krishna for winning a lottery prize, he is a Hindu? Or would you say that a man who has become a sannyasi, who wants to attain moksha, he is a Hindu? How would you say? So to define who a Hindu is difficult, almost impossible. I will re-question you. You say that a Hindu does not practice Hinduism. Now I question you, whom do you call a Hindu? Tell me, whom do you call a Hindu? Then he will come out with an answer. Then I will say there is a true Hindu, that is the 10% Hindu, the 80% Hindu, 60% Hindu, 10% Hindu. There are several cadres. All are Hindus only. Whereas in the case of other religions, it is not like that. Their code of living is small. If they do it, they call themselves a true practitioner of that religion. So you cannot compare a Hindu with a practitioner of other religions. The comparison is wrong. Swamiji's question is a little intricate. There are some religions which advocate polygamy, frequent marriages, because the population is, so to increase population, get married to as many wives as possible. In the name of religion, they do it. What do you say about that? Now, when that particular religion was propounded, the situation was such that very many battles were fought, and the population of menfolk was very small. For three men, there were 50 women, because in battles they lost their lives. Now the leader of the religion, he wanted that particular community to increase the population of men. So what is the only way? So many men are unmarried. So let each man marry three or four. Let them get progeny so that our community increases in population. So what he did was correct from his viewpoint because of the social situation. But that does not apply to all communities, all times. But that's what they are trying to do now. They are trying to bring that civilization here. He says even here we can follow that. No. It is circumstantial. It is relating to time. It must not become anachronistic. Am I clear?
Taking the cue from your answer, in our attempt to make Hinduness quite embracing, and the concept of Hinduism and Hindu Dharma as vast as possible, have we not made the definition of Hinduism, Hindus quite nebulous, and also the concept of Hindu Dharma as such quite confusing? For example, let me speak of the different practices relating to the celebration of Yugadi, for example. There are two different days for celebration of Yugadi, or different days that are prescribed for the celebration of Ekadashi. There is a tremendous diversity. Whereas in other religions which have emanated from the Middle East and the West, there is a definiteness. Is this not a weakness of Hindu Dharma, or do you think that it is a strength?
Now we have to understand one basic thing. All festivals and upavasas we undertake, they have been prescribed by our rishis, not with chronistic importance. Their motive was the result. Take for instance Ekadasi. If you turn the pages of a calendar, you can find Ekadasi begins on 14th. It carries on to 15th. It is over by evening of 15th. Now I get a phone, sir, 2 days Ekadasi. Which day is my Ekadasi, sir? Now, this is a very confusing question. How can one Ekadasi be spread into 2 days? Then I ask him, to what sampradaya you belong? In Vaishnavism, in Tamil Vaishnavism, there is one Tenkalai and there is one Vadakalai. Tenkalai sampradayam, they take one way. Vadakalai sampradayam, they take one way. One man takes the first day, one man takes the second day. Now the rishis say, we are not particular about the exact date. We are particular about the hunger he follows. God wants you to starve for 30 days a year. One Ekadasi every month. Or 2 Ekadasi. So, there are 25 Ekadasis, I think. Also, if you sum it up, say 25 days per year, you must starve. Why? The reason is, you know, there is holiday for a government servant. There is holiday for a private servant also. But there is no holiday for our stomach. Night and day they keep on feeding. By 1 o'clock you go to fast food center, eat something. By 2 at night you drink something. So we keep on nagging our system, digestive system, that badly. Only very few people eat thrice a day. Mostly people eat 4 times, 5 times, 6 times. And they will give a nomenclature also. They will say, sir, pre-breakfast, then breakfast, then post-breakfast, then pre-lunch, lunch, post-lunch, then pre-tiffin, tiffin, post-tiffin, then pre-dinner, dinner, post-dinner. So what we do is right only, natural only. You simply sum up and see how many times you eat. And particularly these office workers, you know, they work on files, you see. Once in 1 hour, they go to the canteen. They ask, you know, you ask them why they are doing like this. What head-breaking job, man. Keep on doing file work, file work, file. You know, when you do the work properly, what happens? Our manager sends 50 files, keep it on his table. He will do it very properly. Only the working man gets more and more work. So to avoid that, we have to take tea, we have to smoke. Luckily, the canteen fellow has biscuits also. So Lord Krishna knows this. If this digestive system is teased like this, if it goes on like that, number one, hygienically he will be affected. Number two, the residue of food forms a tamasic food. It gives you tamasic radiation. You lose memory power, you become sluggish, your briskness goes. So he wants us to starve at least once a day, once a month. So Ekadasi is meant for that. Luckily, he gave a story. There was a Papa Purusha. He went and applied to Lord Vishnu. Where am I to reside, sir? Anybody who eats on Ekadasi day, sit upon his rice or wheat or banana, whatever he eats, catch him, tease him. So that way he gave a boon. So anybody who eats on Ekadasi day will be affected by Papa Purusha. And you know the way our people found to escape from this. I know a man who will eat all this sweet shop items, kesari, Mysore pak, laddu, things like that, on Ekadasi day. He said, Shastras say, Papa Purusha sits on rice only. I don't eat rice. I eat laddu. I eat halwa like that. So Papa Purusha cannot come to me. So that way they try to escape. But by Anna he meant any kind of food, whether it is fruit or milk. And then there is another question. How do you account for sick people who cannot starve? Doctor says you must never be empty stomached. For these people there is an exception. Shastras say, can take one or two fruits, a cup of milk, okay, stop with that. But these people find a stealthy way also. In the name of fruits, they eat a dozen bananas. In the name of milk, they drink 1 liter of milk. And you can live for 3 days, man, by the strength of this food. So there, the concept of Ekadasi is gone. So the motive is more important than the calendar day. Similarly, this Yugadi, that is, there are two calendars followed. One is Chandramana, another is Sauramana. If you calculate according to the solar map, the date will differ. If you calculate according to Chandramana, it will differ. If you read Mahabharata, you find, you see, Pandavas who were hiding in Virata Desha, they exposed themselves on a day which they thought is the first day of the 14th year. But Duryodhana said, according to my calculation, there is still more 1 day. So according to the promise, they must go back to forest for another 12 years. Then Bhishmacharya says, your calculation is Sauramana, their calculation is Chandramana. They belong to the dynasty of Chandra only. So what they do is right. So there we find both the calendars are held true. So there calculation only is important. We adhere to it for bhavanartha. Bhavanartha means for the sake of fulfilling the scriptures, not for calculations.
It's an interesting question from one young man, I suppose, Mr. Sachidananda. He asks, nowadays youth have tendency of asking questions for everything. Is it right approach or not? Because most elders are not happy with this questioning and tendency.
Please say it.
Youth have the tendency of asking.
The question is, the younger generation of modern society has a curiosity to ask more and more questions. Is it right or not? You know, asking questions started during the Vedic period. There is a Upanishad called Kena Upanishad. The Kena Upanishad is completely full of questions. Why? What? How? That is how they found out God. Neiti, neiti, not this is not God, this is not God. So keeping aside things, they found out real God. By questions only, philosophy grew. By questions only, religion grew. And that is the individuality of Hinduism. If you start questioning in other religions, they'll say, shut up. Have faith, go home. That's all. But in Hinduism, we have answer for every question. I have been telling that there is no question for which we can say there is no answer. And I have been meeting this challenge for the last 40 years. I have been traveling from Kashmir to Cape Comorin. I have gone to France. I have met the most curious audience. I have been shooting questions of several kinds. I said there is no question for which there is no answer in Hinduism. Every question has an answer. So that young man, if he asks question, that means he has been blessed by God. He is going to get enlightenment. So encourage him and send him to a proper person. I give you a quotation. Uttishtata, Jagrata, Prapya Varan and Nibodhata. Attain good gurus and get knowledge. Stop not till you get what you want. So questions are welcome. They are good symptoms. And if you can approach the right person, you are going to become a Mahan.
Recently, I saw the title of a program of a TV host, TV anchor. The title went like this. Have we become a nation of hurt sentiments?
Have we become
a nation of hurt sentiments?
What do you mean by that?
Say, are we becoming prone to arguing that our sentiments are hurt?
again and again, even for small reasons. As a matter of fact, that title was given by that anchor of a particular left liberal news channel only when somebody in Canada denigrated the image of Mother Kali. However, a different yardstick was applied to a comment made by another person of Hindu community. So, is it that Hindus don't have any sentiments at all? Is it that they become a convenient target for the purpose of vilifying their gods and goddesses? As a matter of fact, Hindus have welcomed and respected religions and their sentiments throughout their history. So, the argument given by the so-called liberals is that there is freedom of speech. Therefore, we can criticize, mock and denigrate Hindu gods and goddesses. Now, is it not the selective application of the doctrine of free speech? How do you react to this?
You know, there are very many individualities of Hinduism. I gave a lecture that there are 108 individualities in Hinduism. That is, those things are not found in other religions. Only Hinduism has it. Of that 108 individualities, one is, a Hindu is unbelievably patient. His patience is due to his Vedic reading, which says that those people who insult Hinduism do it out of ignorance because they have not yet attained the light of knowledge as you have attained. So bear with him, be patient. So this patience is taught by scriptures in Hinduism, whereas no religion teaches this patience. You go to a man of any other religion in the world, you insult his religion, you will be definitely slapped, you will be definitely beaten, you will be punished. Whereas, if you insult a Hindu, his religion, he would either be calm and patient, or he will say quietly, "What you say is not right, man. You can't understand it now. A day will come when you will understand it." These are the only two possible behaviors. I have not come across a Hindu still who reacts violently for such a remark, because this forbearance is inborn for a Hindu. Every Hindu has this quality. When Pandavas were unjustly usurped of their properties, they know that Kauravas did wrong, but they did not do anything violently. They simply went to the forest. They accepted their decree. Why? Patience is inborn for every Hindu. So it does not speak bad of Hindu, it speaks well of Hindu. It is because of that patience only Hinduism is surviving even now. And it will keep on surviving.
I have a small doubt regarding this articulation of patience. What is the limit of the patience? If at all we go on propagating patience, does it not become a philosophy of pessimism? There is David Foley who articulates very strongly that the need of the hour for Hindus is to become Bauddhika Kshatriyas. So, there is a rule for monks and spiritual people, and there is also a dharma of the householders who have to oppose what is wrong in the society. I think that's what Bhagavad Gita says. So, in the face of the attacks against Hindu society and Hinduism, which we have never seen so far, how do we protect the interests of the Hindu society? Is it not a need on the part of a section of the society to become at least Bauddhika Kshatriyas, if not to take law in their hands?
Now, I spoke of the Hindus' patience. The patience has two levels. One is the bearable level, the other one the retorting level. There is the retorting level also. Lord Krishna preached patience in Bhagavad Gita, but the same Krishna says, when it goes beyond a limit, when it affects the basic faith of Hindus, when it affects the religious health of a nation, you must take the sword and fight to safeguard the religion. That is why he conducted the war of Mahabharata. He wanted Dharma to be established. So when the roots of Hindu religion are being shaken by the non-Hindus, the Hindus need not be patient. They can react as much as needed. And that is how this Golwalkar and other people, they formed organizations to retort, and at least for the sake of defense, you must do it. You would have heard about a famous story by Ramakrishna. It seems a sadhu told a cobra, don't bite anybody. So it stopped biting. After some days, the same sadhu came and met the cobra. It was seriously wounded, damaged. What happened? You said, don't bite anybody. I became a good snake. What happened? Everybody stoned me. My condition is like this. Then the sadhu said, I said, don't bite. I never said, don't hiss. You can create a noise like that. Frighten them. Safeguard yourself. So defensive violence is good. It is not bad. The same is good in army also. In today's army, Indian army, of course, shoots down enemies only when they go beyond a limit. And that's good. You can do it. Nothing wrong. And the Shastras say, a Kshatriya must not bear with any insult from others. He must not practice patience. A sadhu can practice patience, not a Kshatriya. Similarly, people who are in the capacity of safeguarding the welfare of our religion, they can resort to violence to that much of a quantity which is needed, just barely needed.
This is the last question of this interaction. One who has written the question has not written the name, but this is a very pertinent question for all the youth. Therefore, I would like to ask the question. The question is here. Does someone really need a mentor in his or her life? Or he or she can be his or her own mentor?
No, what he asks is, mentor means guru. Do we really need a guru? Can't we attain salvation without a guru? What is the need for a guru? Now the explanation is simple. If you just understand what a guru does, this question will vanish. You know, during Olympic Games, when the Olympic Games start, you know, as an initial ceremony, one of the sportsmen takes the torch, Olympic torch, runs a certain distance, goes to another country, he hands over the torch to the sportsman of that country. He receives it, he runs, he hands it over to the sportsman of another country. Like that, by relay race, ultimately these burning flames, it reaches the Olympic grounds. Then they light the Olympic flame, then they start it. Now just think of one and the same man running the whole distance. Say the first sportsman starts from India. The Olympics is going to take place in North America. If you tell him you run the whole distance till America, what will happen? He will die when he is reaching Arabia. That's all. So we adopt relay. Similarly, who is a guru? Guru is a man who has earned God's grace, certain amount of God's grace already. When you go to a guru, he blesses you that God will bless you to that extent as he has earned his grace so far. So because of the blessing of guru, the disciple, without starting any upasana, as a fixed deposit, as an initial deposit, he gets the blessings of God. Now, this guru would have become the disciple of his guru, and his guru would have become the disciple of that guru. This relay race is starting from Lord Narayana in Badrikashrama. So, guru after guru, guru after guru, guru after guru, while it reaches me, when I approach my guru, you can add up all blessings. So I get a capital blessing of God. What all these gurus suffer to get, I get without any suffering. It's like getting a treasure. So they said, go to your guru. Don't be egoistic. I need no guru. I am a great man. I can approach God directly. If you go directly, what will happen? You see, you want to meet the Prime Minister. You need some recommendation, some MP or some minister, and show the letter to the Diwali, then he will take you inside. If you ignore all this protocol, you straight away dash into his office. What happens? The Diwali pulls you out, kicks you heavily, hands you over to the police. You can't go and meet the Prime Minister like that. So God says, you meet me easily through this Acharya Parampara. Acharya Parampara is for you only, not for my benefit. Avail it, make use of it. So then, when that is the case, why do you say, why should I go to your guru? It's an egoistic question. Am I clear?
Because of paucity of time, we close the interaction here itself. Joseph G will be with us tomorrow and day after tomorrow also. He might take up some of the unanswered questions later.
So we are meeting tomorrow.
In those functions, yes.
Okay.
Perhaps Swamiji wanted us to see a true Hindu, though the first name of Joseph Iyengar is a non-Hindu name. So I believe that the interaction has been quite interesting. Now I request Sri Joseph Iyengar to deliver his concluding speech. After that, Revered Swamiji will bless us.
A short speech. I said, I will explain three kinds of personalities. One Jovian, other is Martian, other is Venusian. You know, Jyotisha Shastra is a vast ocean. The Indian Jyotisha Shastra, it has produced hundreds and hundreds of books. I have a few of them in original Sanskrit. In Jyotisha Shastra, they have classified men into five categories as five Mahapurushas. Number one, if in your horoscope Jupiter is in Swakshetra. Swakshetra means its own house. And if that happens to be either 1 or 4 or 7 or 10, it is called Hamsa Yoga. This man of Hamsa Yoga is the first Mahapurusha. Him we call as Jovian. Number two, if Mercury is like that, he is a second Mahapurusha. Number three, if Mars is like that, he is called a Martian Mahapurusha. Then if Venus is like that, he is called a Venusian Mahapurusha. If Saturn is like that, he is called a Saturnian Mahapurusha. Now I will take first the description of a Saturnian Mahapurusha. If Saturn is in either 1 or 4 or 7 or 10, and if it happens to be a Swakshetra, his own house, it is called Sasha Yoga. And people who have this Sasha Yoga will be leaders of smugglers, fake currency printers, murderers, bandits, on all left-hand route practitioners. And we have had very famous plunderers in our country. you know, our Chambal Valley plunderers, they were also big leaders. And people who commit murders for money, killers, professional killers, and people who are selling toddy unlawfully, they will have gundas in their control. This Sasha Yoga, normally noble people don't take into account, but there are Saturnian leaders in society. Once you hear of a man like that, you can come to a conclusion that Saturn is in a strong position in his horoscope. Lord Krishna calls such people in the Bhagavad Gita as people of Asura Sampath. Asura Sampath means they will also be rich, they will be leaders, they will be influential, but all on the wrong side. I don't want any of you to become a Saturnian leader. So I don't want to preach you that side. If you want to become a Saturnian leader, you must worship these petty deities, Alpadevata, tamasic deities. They will give you that strength. Now, leave alone that. If Jupiter is strong in your horoscope, you will be called a Jovian personality. A Jovian is usually religious, very spiritual, will have some spiritual powers. Mostly he will be a Mataadhipati or a spiritual leader or a preacher or a converter, things like that. And if you are very much interested in spiritual practices, you would become a Jovian personality. Second is Martian. Mars means Kuja in the horoscope. Kuja belongs to the army, military. Lord Subramania is the deity for that. These people will be warlike. They will be short-tempered. They will like hot foods. They would like military practices. They either join the army or police department, or they will become a strict leader in some business concern. Then the third, the next one is Venusian. Venus is Lord Shukra. People who are with Shukramsa, they will be interested in fine arts, music, dance, acting, glamour, window dressing, painting, sculpture, and such things. And all cinema actors are Venusians only. You can become a Venusian personality, but you will be forced to have loose morals, and society will not like you. You will be wasting your soul, spiritual life. So these are the main dominating leadership. I would advise you either to become a Jovian personality or a little Martian personality. These two personalities will make you successful in practical life as well as safeguard your spiritual progress also. And how to attain this is a long story, and you will have to sit for several lectures for which we are not ready now. So as I have been requested, I think I can take leave of you. I earnestly thank our Swamiji who arranged for this rare meeting, and to all my well wishes who have been helping me today for this meeting. And mostly I thank you people who have been patiently sitting here to listen, because normally when someone talks on religious topic, they would move away gradually. And that man is called as an axa blade. He starts cutting your neck. And they don't like it. But surprisingly enough, the audience remains the same in number from the beginning till last. And that shows the temperament you have. I should thank you all. And if God willing, we'll be meeting very shortly, tomorrow or day after. And I pray for you all. Thank you. Jai Sriman Narayan.
Iga Sanmana, Sri D.A. Joseph Aurige, Pramupujya Swamiji Varu, Auranna Sanmana Sabekagi, Aura Livinanti. I request Swamiji to felicitate Sri D.A. Joseph.
ಪೂಜ್ಯ ಶ್ರೀ ಶ್ರೀ ಈಶ್ವಪ್ರಿಯ ತೀರ್ಥ ಶ್ರೀಪಾದರಿಂದ ಅನುಗ್ರಹ ಸಂದೇಶ ಈಗ.
ಶ್ರೀ ಗುರುಭ್ಯೋ ನಮಃ. ಹರಿ ಓಂ. ಟುಡೇ ಇಸ್ ಎ ವೆರಿ ಸ್ಪೆಷಲ್ ಡೇ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಡಿ ಎ ಜೋಸೆಫ್ ಈಸ್ ವಿತ್ ಅಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಎ special occasion where we can prove what is Indian culture actually, because we have a live example here who studied Puranas and Bhagavata etc. So this shows India will always give better opportunity who really wants to get knowledge. Andre ondu aapadanegalu nammele nirantaravagi ide enu andre Bharatadalli ondashtu jatigalive. ಕೆಲವರನ್ನು ತುಳಿದಿದ್ದಾರೆ, ಅದು ಹಾಗಿಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ ಇವತ್ತು ಜೋಸೆಫ್ ಅವರು ತೋರಿಸ್ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ನಿಜವಾಗಿ ಯಾರಿಗೆ ಜ್ಞಾನವನ್ನು ಪಡಿಲೇಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಇಚ್ಛೆ ಇದೆ ಅವನಿಗೆ ಜ್ಞಾನವನ್ನು ಕೊಡುವವರು ಖಂಡಿತವಾಗಿ ಭಾರತದಲ್ಲಿ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ಅನ್ನೋದನ್ನು ತೋರಿಸಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅವರು ಕಲ್ತಿದ್ದಾರೆ, ಸಾಕಷ್ಟು ಕಡೆ ಅದನ್ನು ಕೊಡ್ತಾ ಕೂಡ ಬಂದಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಇವತ್ತಿನ ಈ ಎಲ್ಲ ತುಂಬ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆಗಳ ನಡುವೆ ಬಂದಂಥ ವಿಷಯಗಳನ್ನು ಗಮನಿಸಿದಾಗ ಇವತ್ತು ಕೂಡ ಸಾಕಷ್ಟು ಜನ ತುಡಿತವುಳ್ಳವರು, ಅಂದರೆ ಹಿಂದೂ ಧರ್ಮದ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಅಥವಾ ಧರ್ಮದ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ತಿಳಿಯಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ತುಡಿತವುಳ್ಳವರು ಖಂಡಿತವಾಗಿ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಮತ್ತು ಅದನ್ನು ಕೊಟ್ಟರೆ ಖಂಡಿತವಾಗಿ ಬಲಿಷ್ಠವಾದ ಒಂದು ಧಾರ್ಮಿಕ ಪ್ರಜ್ಞೆ ಉಳ್ಳ ಜನಾಂಗ ತಯಾರಾಗಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಭಾರತ ಸಿದ್ಧವಾಗಿದೆ ಅನ್ನೋದು ಕೂಡ ತೋರಿಸಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಸತ್ಯನಿಷ್ಠತೆ ಮತ್ತು ದೇವರಲ್ಲಿ ನಂಬಿಕೆ ಇದು ಒಟ್ಟಿಗೆ ಇರಬಹುದಾ ಅನ್ನುವಂಥ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆ ಬಂತು. ಅಂದರೆ ತುಂಬ ಭಕ್ತಿ ಅಂತ ನಮಗೆ ಕಾಣಿಸುತ್ತೆ, ಆದರೆ ಮಾಡೋ ಕೆಲಸಗಳು ಸರಿ ಇರಲ್ಲ, ಸಂಪತ್ತನ್ನು ಗಳಿಸುವ ಮೆಥಡಾಲಜಿಗಳು ಸರಿ ಇರೋದಿಲ್ಲ, ಆದರೆ ಭಕ್ತಿಯ ಪ್ರತೀಕವಾಗಿ ದೇವರ ಆರಾಧನೆಗಳು ಕಾಣಿಸ್ತವೆ. ಇಂಥ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆಗಳು ಬಂತು. ನಿಜವಾಗಿ ಇದು ಒಬ್ಬನಲ್ಲಿರುವ ಗೊಂದಲಗಳನ್ನು ತಿಳಿಸ್ಕೊಡ್ತಾ ಇದೆ. ಅಂದರೆ ಸಮಾಜದಲ್ಲಿ ಇಂಥ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆಗೆ ನಾವು ಉತ್ತರ ಕೊಡದೇ ಇದ್ದರೆ ಅದು ಕೊಳೆತ ಕುಂಬಳಕಾಯಿ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. ನೋಡಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಹೊರಗಡೆ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿದೆ, ಆದರೆ ಒಳಗಡೆ ಇಲ್ಲ, ಯಾಕಂದರೆ ಇಂಥದಕ್ಕೆಲ್ಲ ಉತ್ತರ ಸಿಗ್ತಾ ಇಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ. ಪ್ರಾಯ ಇಂಥ ಉದ್ದೇಶಗಳನ್ನೆಲ್ಲ ಇಟ್ಟುಕೊಂಡು ನಾವು ಈ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದು ಅದು ಪರ್ಯಾಯದ ಅವಧಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಅದರ ಫಲ ಅದು ನಮಗೆ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಮಟ್ಟಿಗೆ ಕಾಣಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದೆ. ಮತ್ತು ಇದನ್ನು ಇಂಥ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆಗಳನ್ನು ಗುರಿಯಾಗಿಸಿಕೊಂಡು ಉತ್ತರ ಕೊಡಿಸುವಂಥ ಒಂದು ಪ್ರಯತ್ನವೇ ಈ ವೇದಿಕೆ ವಿಶ್ವಾರ್ಪಣದ ಒಂದು ಚಿಂತನೆ ಆ ದೃಷ್ಟಿಯಿಂದ ಸಾಗಿದೆ. ಒಬ್ಬ ನಿಜವಾದ ಭಕ್ತ ದೇವರನ್ನು ಉಪಾಸನೆ ಮಾಡುವವನು ತುಂಬ ಎತ್ತರಕ್ಕೆ ಹೋಗಿದ್ದರೆ ಖಂಡಿತವಾಗಿ ಅವನಿಂದ ಸಮಾಜಕ್ಕೆ ಯಾವ ಬಗೆಯ ದ್ರೋಹವೂ ಆಗೋದಿಲ್ಲ. ಯಾಕಂದರೆ ಭಗವಂತ ವಿಷ್ಣು ಅಂತ ಅವನು ಉಪಾಸನೆ ಮಾಡ್ತಾನೆ, ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ಭಗವಂತ ಎಲ್ಲ ಕಡೆ ಇದ್ದಾನೆ ಅನ್ನುವ ಅರಿವು ಅವನಿಗಿರ್ತದೆ. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ಯಾವ ಅನ್ಯಾಯವನ್ನು ನಾನು ಮಾಡಿದರೂ ಕೂಡ ಅದು ಭಗವಂತನಿಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಾಗದೆ ಇರೋದಿಲ್ಲ ಅನ್ನೋದು ಅವನಿಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಿರುತ್ತೆ. ಆದ್ದರಿಂದ ಅವನಿಂದ ಅನ್ಯಾಯಗಳು ಆಗೋದಿಲ್ಲ. ಹಾಗಾದರೆ ಹಾಗೆ ಕಾಣಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದೆಯಲ್ಲ ಪ್ರಪಂಚದಲ್ಲಿ ಅಂತ ಕೇಳಿದರೆ ಅವರಿಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಿಲ್ಲ ಅಂತಷ್ಟ. ಅವರು ಇನ್ನೂ ದೇವರನ್ನು ತಿಳಿದಿಲ್ಲ ಅಥವಾ ಅವರಿಗೆ ಅದರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಅರಿವಿಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ ಅರ್ಥ. ಆವಾಗಲೇ ನಮ್ಮ ಮಾತುಗಳ ನಡುವೆ ಬಂದಂತೆ ಆಸ್ ಇ ಸೆಡ್ 80% ಹಿಂದೂ, 20% ಹಿಂದೂ, ಅವರನ್ನು ಯಾವುದೋ ಒಂದು ಕ್ಯಾಟಗರಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಸೇರಿಸ್ಬೇಕು. ಅವರ ಒಂದು ಬಿಹೇವಿಯರನ್ನು ನೋಡಿ ಅವರು ಎಲ್ಲಿ ಸೇರಿಸ್ಬೋದು ಅಂತ. ಅಂದರೆ ಯಾವಾಗಲೂ ಎಲ್ಲ ಕಡೆ ನಾನು ಉಪಯೋಗ ಮಾಡ್ತೇನೆ ಇದನ್ನು, ಸನಾತನ ಧರ್ಮದವರು ನಾವು ಅಂತ ನಾವು ಹೇಳ್ಕೊಳ್ತೇವೆ. ಆದರೆ ಸನಾತನ ಧರ್ಮವನ್ನು ಆಚರಣೆ ಮಾಡಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಬಯಸುವವರು ನಾವು, ಆದ್ದರಿಂದ ಸನಾತನ ಧರ್ಮೀಯರು ಅಂತ ನಾವು ಹೇಳ್ಕೊಳ್ತೇವೆ ಹೊರತು ಸನಾತನ ಧರ್ಮೀಯರು ಅಲ್ಲ ನಾವು. ಯಾಕೆ ಅಂದರೆ ಧರ್ಮ ಏನು ಅಂತ ನಮಗೆ ಸರಿಯಾಗಿ ಗೊತ್ತಿಲ್ಲದೆ ಹೋದರೆ, ಧರ್ಮ ಎಂಬುದು ಅದು ಕಾಲಕ್ಕೆ ಬದಲಾಗುವುದಿಲ್ಲ, ಮತ್ತು ದೇಶದಲ್ಲಿ ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ದೇಶಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಬದಲಾಗುವುದಿಲ್ಲ. ಆದ್ದರಿಂದ ಧರ್ಮ ಎಂಬುದು ಒಂದೇ ಥರ ಇರುತ್ತೆ, ಅದಕ್ಕೋಸ್ಕರ ಒಂದೇ ಥರ ಇರೋದರಿಂದ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಸನಾತನ ಧರ್ಮ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ. ಅಂತಹ ಸನಾತನ ಧರ್ಮವನ್ನು ನಾವು ಗ್ರಂಥಾದಿಗಳಿಂದ ತಿಳ್ಕೊಂಡು, ಅದೇ ರೀತಿ ಹಿರಿಯರಿಂದ ತಿಳ್ಕೊಂಡು ನಾವು ಆಚರಣೆ ಮಾಡಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಪ್ರಯತ್ನ ಮಾಡ್ತೇವೆ, ಆದ್ದರಿಂದ ಸನಾತನ ಧರ್ಮೀಯರು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತೇವೆ. ಆದರೆ ನಿಜವಾಗಿ ಸನಾತನ ಧರ್ಮ ನಮ್ಮಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಅಳವಡಿಸ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದೇವಾ ಅಂತ ಕೇಳಿದರೆ ಅದು ಇಲ್ಲ ಅಂತಲೇ ಹೇಳಬೇಕಾಗತ್ತೆ. ಅದರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಒಬ್ಬೊಬ್ಬರಲ್ಲಿ ಹೆಚ್ಚು, ಒಬ್ಬರಲ್ಲಿ ಕಡಿಮೆ, ಒಬ್ಬರಲ್ಲಿ ಹೆಚ್ಚು, ಒಬ್ಬರಲ್ಲಿ ಕಡಿಮೆ ಅಂತ ಕಾಣಿಸ್ಬೋದು. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ದೇವರು ಎಂಬುವವನು ಪ್ಯೂರೆಸ್ಟ್, ಆ ಪ್ಯೂರಿಟಿಯನ್ನು ನಾವು ತಂದುಕೊಳ್ಳಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಪ್ರಯತ್ನ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇರ್ತೇವೆ. ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಸಾಧನೆ ಇದ್ದಲ್ಲಿ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಪ್ಯೂರಿಟಿ ಎಂಬುದು ಇರ್ತದೆ. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ಈ ಪ್ರಯತ್ನದಲ್ಲಿ ಪ್ರತಿಯೊಬ್ಬರೂ ಜ್ಞಾನವನ್ನು ಪಡೆದಾಗ ಮಾತ್ರವೇ ಒಂದೊಂದೇ ಹಂತದ ಮೇಲೆ ಹೋಗಿ 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 ಒಳ್ಳೆಯ ಪ್ರಾಕ್ಟೀಸ್ ಮಾಡುವವನು, ಅಭ್ಯಾಸ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇರುವವನು ಅಂತ ಅನ್ನಿಸ್ಕೊಳ್ತಾನೆ. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ನಿರಂತರ ನಮ್ಮ ಪ್ರಯತ್ನ ಇರಬೇಕು. ನಹಿ ಜ್ಞಾನೇನ ಸದೃಶಂ ಪವಿತ್ರಮಿಹ ವಿದ್ಯತೆ ಅಂತ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಅದೇ ಕಾರಣಕ್ಕಾಗಿ ಹೇಳಿದ್ದು, ಜ್ಞಾನವನ್ನು ಪಡೀಬೇಕು ಅಂತ. ಜ್ಞಾನವನ್ನು ಪಡೆದಾಗ ಧರ್ಮ ಯಾವುದು ಅಧರ್ಮ ಯಾವುದು ಅಂತ ಡಿಸೈಡ್ ಮಾಡಲಿಕ್ಕಾಗ್ತದೆ. ಅದು ಸಾಂದರ್ಭಿಕ ಧರ್ಮ. ಇವತ್ತು ಯಾವುದು ಧರ್ಮ ಅಂತ ನಾನಿಲ್ಲಿ ಘೋಷಣೆ ಮಾಡಿದರೆ ನಾಳೆಗೆ ಅದು ಅಧರ್ಮ ಆಗಬಹುದು. ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಒಂದು ಸಣ್ಣ ಉದಾಹರಣೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣನ ಮಾತುಗಳೇ, ಅದನ್ನು ಈಗ ಹೇಳಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಏನು, ಯುದ್ಧ ಮಾಡಬಾರ್ದು, ಅಹಿಂಸೆ ಮಾಡಬಾರ್ದು. ಅಹಿಂಸೆ, ಅಹಿಂಸಾ ಪರಮೋ ಧರ್ಮ ಅಂತ ಯಾವಾಗಲೂ ನಾವು ನಿತ್ಯದಲ್ಲಿ ಮಾತಾಡ್ತಾ ಇರ್ತೇವೆ. ಅಹಿಂಸೆ ನಾವು ಅಳವಡಿಸ್ಕೊಳ್ಬೇಕು. ಆದರೆ ಅಂತಹ ಅಹಿಂಸಾ ತತ್ವವನ್ನು ಅಳವಡಿಸ್ಕೊಳ್ಳುವುದರಿಂದ ಒಂದು ಜನಾಂಗವೇ ನಾಶ ಆಗಿ ಹೋಗ್ತದೆ ಅಂತಾದರೆ ಅಂತಹ ಸಮಯದಲ್ಲಿ ಅಹಿಂಸೆ ಬೇಡ ಅಂತ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಹೇಳಿದ್ದಾನೆ. ಯುದ್ಧ ಮಾಡು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ. ಯಾಕೆ, ದುರ್ಯೋಧನನ ಒಂದು ಹಂತ ತನಕ ಅವನಿಗೆ ಕೊಡುವಷ್ಟು ಎಲ್ಲ ಸ್ವಾತಂತ್ರ್ಯವನ್ನು ಕೊಟ್ಟು ನೋಡಿ ಆಯಿತು, ಅವಕಾಶಗಳನ್ನು ಕೊಟ್ಟು ನೋಡಿ ಆಯಿತು, ಆದರೂ ಸರಿ ಆಗಲಿಲ್ಲ. ಇನ್ನು ಹಾಗಾದರೆ ಈ ಎರಡನೇ ಪ್ರಯೋಗವನ್ನು ಮಾಡಬೇಕು, ಯುದ್ಧ ಮಾಡೋದೇ ಉಚಿತ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ ತೋರಿಸಿಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾನೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣ. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ಕಾಲಭೇದದಿಂದ ನಮ್ಮ ಚಿಂತನೆಗಳ ಭೇದ ಆಗಬೇಕು, ಅದು ಧರ್ಮ ಆಗಿರ್ತದೆ. ಉದಾಹರಣೆಗೆ ರಾಮನ ಕಾಲಕ್ಕೆ ಹೋದರೆ ರಾಮನ ಕಥೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಎಲ್ಲಿಯೂ ಕೂಡ ಕೃಷ್ಣನ ರೀತಿಯ ಸುಳ್ಳು ಹೇಳುವಿಕೆ ಅಂತ ನಮಗೆ ಯಾವುದು ಕಾಣಿಸ್ತದೋ ಅದಿಲ್ಲ. ಆದರೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣನ ಪ್ರತಿ ಹೆಜ್ಜೆಯೂ ಕೂಡ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಕಳ್ಳ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳುವಂತೆ ನಮಗೆ ಕಾಣಿಸ್ತದೆ. ಕಾಲ ವ್ಯತ್ಯಾಸ ಆಯಿತು, ಆವಾಗ ನಮ್ಮ ಚಿಂತನ ಶೈಲಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಬದಲಾಗಲೇಬೇಕಾಗತ್ತೆ. ಎದುರಿಗೆ ಕಳ್ಳ ಬಂದರೆ ನಾವು ಅವನಿಂದ ರಕ್ಷಣೆಗೋಸ್ಕರ ಕೆಲವೊಂದು ಚಿಂತನೆಗಳನ್ನು ಮಾಡಿಕೊಂಡು ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಸರಿಯಾದ ಒಂದು ಪ್ರತಿಕ್ರಿಯೆಯನ್ನು ಕೊಡಬೇಕಾಗತ್ತೆ. ಎದುರಿಗೆ ಸಾತ್ವಿಕ ಇರುವಾಗ ಬೇರೆ ಥರ ಪ್ರತಿಕ್ರಿಯೆ. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ಧರ್ಮ ಯಾವುದು ಅಂತ ಗೊತ್ತಾಗುವುದು ತುಂಬ ಕಷ್ಟ. ಅದನ್ನು ಆನಂದ ತೀರ್ಥರು ಹೇಳಿದ್ದಾರೆ, ಧರ್ಮಸ್ಯ ಚರಣಂ ಶ್ರೇಯ ಧರ್ಮ ಜ್ಞಾನಂತು ದುಷ್ಕರಂ ಅಂತ. ಧರ್ಮ ಆಚರಿಸೋದು ತುಂಬ ಶ್ರೇಷ್ಠಪ್ಪ, ಆದರೆ ಧರ್ಮ ಯಾವುದು ಅಂತ ತಿಳಿಯೋದು ತುಂಬ ಕಷ್ಟ ಇದೆ ಅಂತ. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ಈ ಒಂದು ಪ್ರಜ್ಞೆ ನಮ್ಮಲ್ಲಿ ಸಮಾಜದಲ್ಲಿ ಬೆಳೀಬೇಕು. ಯಾವುದು ಧರ್ಮ, ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ನಾವು ಯಾವ ಕಾಲದಲ್ಲಿ ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ನಮ್ಮ ರಿಯಾಕ್ಷನ್ಸ್ ಇರಬೇಕು, ಯಾವ ಕಾಲದಲ್ಲಿ ಇಗ್ನೋರ್ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಕೆಲವು ವಿಷಯಗಳನ್ನು, ನಾವಿವತ್ತು ನಮ್ಮ ಶಾಸ್ತ್ರಗಳನ್ನು ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ಬಳಸ್ಕೊಳ್ತೇವೆ ಅಂದರೆ ನಾವು ಆ ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ತಪ್ಪಿಸ್ಕೊಳ್ಳಿಕ್ಕಾಗಿ ಶಾಸ್ತ್ರಗಳನ್ನು ಬಳಸ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೇವೆ. ಉದಾಹರಣೆಗೆ ನಮಗೆ ಯಾವುದೋ ಒಂದು ಕ್ರಿಯೆ ಮಾಡಲಿಕ್ಕಾಗಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ ಒಂದು ಪರಿಸ್ಥಿತಿ ಇದೆ, ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಶಾಸ್ತ್ರ ಹೇಳಿದೆ ಅಹಿಂಸಾ ಪರಮಧರ್ಮ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದೆ. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ಹೊಡೆತ ಕೊಟ್ಟರು ಹೊಡೆತ ತಿಂದು ಬರಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತೇವೆ. ಅದೇ ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ಸರ್ತಿ ಹೊಡಿಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಅವಕಾಶ ಇದೆ, ಹೊಡೆದಾಯಿತು, ಆವಾಗ ನೀನೇ ಹೇಳಿದ್ದಲ್ಲ ಅಹಿಂಸಾ ಅನ್ನೋದು ಅಳವಡಿಸ್ಕೊಳ್ಬೇಕಿತ್ತು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದರೆ ಆವಾಗ ಬೇರೆಯೇ ಹೇಳ್ತೇವೆ. ಅದಕ್ಕೂ ಒಂದು ಶಾಸ್ತ್ರದ ಮಾತು ಹೇಳ್ತೇವೆ. ಅಂದರೆ ನಮ್ಮ ನಡೆಗೆ ಅನುಗುಣವಾಗಿ ಶಾಸ್ತ್ರವನ್ನು ತರ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೇವೆ. ಶಾಸ್ತ್ರ ಏನು ಹೇಳಿದೆ ಅದರ ಪ್ರಕಾರವಾಗಿ ನಾವು ನಡೀತಾ ಇಲ್ಲ ಎಷ್ಟೋ ಬಾರಿ. ಈ ಒಂದು ಚಿಂತನೆ ಮಂಥನಗಳು ನಮ್ಮಲ್ಲಿ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಶಾಸ್ತ್ರಜ್ಞಾನವನ್ನು ಮತ್ತು ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ನಡ್ಕೊಳ್ಳುವುದು ಸರಿ ತಪ್ಪು ಎಂಬ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಜ್ಞಾನವನ್ನು ಕೊಡ್ತವೆ. ತುಂಬ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ನಾನು ಸ್ಪಂದಿಸಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಅಂದುಕೊಳ್ತೇನೆ, ಆದರೆ ಸಮಯದ ಮಿತಿ ಇದೆ. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ಮತ್ತೆ ಮುಂದಿನ ದಿನಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಇದನ್ನೆಲ್ಲ ನೋಡೋಣ. ಈಗ ಉಸಿರಾಟದ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಮಾತು ಬಂತು. ಆಚಾರ್ಯರು ಹೇಳಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಒಬ್ಬ ಮನುಷ್ಯ ಒಂದು ದಿನದಲ್ಲಿ ಎಷ್ಟು ಉಸಿರಾಡ್ತಾನೆ, ಸಾಮಾನ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಉಸಿರಾಡ್ತಾನೆ, ಅದನ್ನು ಅದರ ನಡುವಿನ ಅಂತರವನ್ನು ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಹೋದರೆ ಆವಾಗ ಅವನಿಗೆ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಆಯುಷ್ಯ ಲಭಿಸ್ತದೆ. ಅಂದರೆ ನಂಬರ್ ಆಫ್ ಸೈಕಲ್ಸ್ ಏನಿದೆ ಉಸಿರಾಟದ್ದು, ಅದು ನಮ್ಮ ಜೀವಿತ ಅವಧಿಯನ್ನು ನಿರ್ಧಾರ ಮಾಡ್ತದೆ ಹೊರತು ಸೂರ್ಯನ ಸುತ್ತ ಭೂಮಿ ತಿರುಗ್ತಿರುವ ನಾವೇನು ಇವತ್ತು ಸಮಯ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತೇವೆ ಅದು ನಿರ್ಧಾರ ಮಾಡುವುದಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ. ಅದೇ ರೀತಿ ಆಯುರ್ವೇದ ಹೇಳುತ್ತದೆ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಆಹಾರ ತಿನ್ನಬೇಡಿ, ಎಷ್ಟು ಬೇಕು ಅಷ್ಟು ಮಾತ್ರ ತಿನ್ನಿ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳುತ್ತೆ. ಯಾಕಂದರೆ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಆಹಾರ ತಿಂದಷ್ಟು ಒಂದು ನಮ್ಮ ದೇಹದೊಳಗಿರುವ ಒಂದು ಮೆಕ್ಯಾನಿಸಮ್ ಇದೆ, ಅದು ಆಹಾರದ ಇಂಟೇಕ್ ಎಷ್ಟು ಅಂತ ಅಬ್ಸರ್ವ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇರ್ತದೆ. ಒಂದು ಲಿಮಿಟ್ ಆದಮೇಲೆ ಅಷ್ಟು ಆದಮೇಲೆ ಬಾಡಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಏನೋ ಒಂದು ಬದಲಾವಣೆಗಳು ಕಾಣಿಸ್ತವೆ. ಅದು ನಮ್ಮ ಚರ್ಮ ಸುಕ್ಕುಗಟ್ಟುವಂಥ ಕ್ರಿಯೆ ಇರ್ಬೋದು, ಆ ಥರ ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ರಿಯಾಕ್ಷನ್ ಒಂದೊಂದು ಹಂತ ಆದ ನಂತರ ಬರ್ತಾ ಹೋಗ್ತದೆ ಅಂತ. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ಆಹಾರ ನಿಯಂತ್ರಣ, ಶರೀರ ರಕ್ಷಣೆ, ನಿದ್ರೆ ಇತ್ಯಾದಿಗಳನ್ನು ಸರಿ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಳ್ಳೋದ್ರ ಮೂಲಕವಾಗಿ, ಅದೇ ರೀತಿ ಉಸಿರಾಟ, ಇದರ ಮೂಲಕವಾಗಿ ನಾವು ಜೀವಿತಾವಧಿಯನ್ನು ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಮಾಡಿಕೊಳ್ಬಹುದು. ಜೀವಿತಾವಧಿಯನ್ನು ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಮಾಡಿಕೊಂಡು ಏನು ಮಾಡಲಿಕ್ಕಾಗಿ ಅಂತ ಕೇಳಿದರೆ ಇದೆ, ಜ್ಞಾನ ಪಡೀಲಿಕ್ಕಾಗಿ, ಭಗವಂತನನ್ನು ಪಡೀಲಿಕ್ಕಾಗಿ ಈ ದೇಹವನ್ನು ಉಪಯೋಗ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಳ್ಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಶಾಸ್ತ್ರಕಾರರ ಅಭಿಪ್ರಾಯ. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ಭಗವಂತನನ್ನು ಕಾಣಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಹೆಚ್ಚಿನ ಜ್ಞಾನ ಬೇಕು, ಜ್ಞಾನ ಪಡೀಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಪೂರಕವಾದ ಪರಿಸರ ಬೇಕು. ಆ ಪರಿಸರ ನಿರ್ಮಾಣ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಳ್ಳುವ ಕ್ರಿಯೆ ಅದು ರಾಷ್ಟ್ರದ ಒಂದು ಪರಿಕಲ್ಪನೆ. ರಾಷ್ಟ್ರ ಅಂತ ಬಂದದ್ದು ಆ ಉದ್ದೇಶದಿಂದ. ಎಲ್ಲರೂ ಕೂಡ ಏಕಮನಸ್ಕರಾಗಿ ಪ್ರಯತ್ನ ಮಾಡುವವರಾದರೆ ಆವಾಗ ಆ ಮಧ್ಯದಲ್ಲಿ ಒಬ್ಬ ಮಹಾಪುರುಷ ಹುಟ್ಟಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ ಅಂತ. ಯತತಾಮಪಿ ಸಿದ್ಧಾನಂ ಕಶ್ಚಿತ್ ಮಾಂ ವೇತ್ತಿ ತತ್ವತಃ ಅಂತ. ಎಷ್ಟೋ ಜನ ಪುರುಷರು ಪ್ರಯತ್ನ ಮಾಡ್ತಿರುವವರ ಮಧ್ಯೆ ಒಬ್ಬ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ತಿಳ್ಕೊಳ್ತಾನೆ, ಅಂತ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ತಿಳ್ಕೊಂಡವರ ಮಧ್ಯೆ ಒಬ್ಬ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಅವನಿಗೆ ದರ್ಶನದ ಒಂದು ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆ ಅದಾಗ್ತದೆ, ಭಗವದ್ ದರ್ಶನ ಆಗಬಹುದು. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ಕೋಟಿ ಕೋಟಿ ಮಂದಿಗಳ ಮಧ್ಯೆ ಒಬ್ಬ ಯಾರೋ ಸಾಧಕ ಇರ್ತಾನೆ, ಅಂತಹ ಸಾಧಕನಿಗೆ ಬೇಕಾದ ಎನ್ವೈರನ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಆ ರಾಷ್ಟ್ರ ಕೊಡ್ತದೆ. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ಆ ಒಬ್ಬ ಸಾಧಕನ ಒಂದು ಪುಣ್ಯಫಲ ಎಂಬಂಥದ್ದು, ಅವನ ಒಂದು ಮೆಸೇಜ್ ಎಂಬಂಥದ್ದು ಇಡೀ ರಾಷ್ಟ್ರವನ್ನು ಮತ್ತೆ ರಕ್ಷಣೆ ಮಾಡ್ತದೆ. ಈ ರೀತಿ ಒಂದು ಸಂಪದ್ಭರಿತವಾದ ಪ್ರದೇಶ ನಿರ್ಮಾಣ ಆಗಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಸಾಧ್ಯ. ಸಾಕಷ್ಟು ವಿಷಯಗಳಿದೆ. ಪ್ರತಿಯೊಬ್ಬ ವ್ಯಕ್ತಿಯು, ಆಚಾರ್ಯರು ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ ಜೀವ ಜೀವಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಭೇದ ಅಂತ, ಪ್ರತಿ ವ್ಯಕ್ತಿಯೂ ಕೂಡ ಅವನದ್ದೇ ಆದ ಒಂದು ಸಾಮರ್ಥ್ಯ ಇದೆ, ಆ ಸಾಮರ್ಥ್ಯಕ್ಕೆ ಅನುಗುಣವಾಗಿ ಅವನಿಗೆ ಹಿಂದೂ ಧರ್ಮದಲ್ಲಿ ಅವಕಾಶ ಇದೆ. ಅವನಿಗೆ ಅವನ ಸಾಮರ್ಥ್ಯಕ್ಕೆ ಸರಿಯಾದ ರೀತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಅವನು ತನ್ನ ಒಂದು ಜೀವನವನ್ನು ನಿರೂಪಿಸಿಕೊಳ್ಬೋದು, ಒಂದು ಅದನ್ನು ಕಟ್ಟಿಕೊಳ್ಬಹುದು. ಅಂದರೆ ಪ್ರತಿ ಕೆಲಸವು ಪ್ರತಿ ಹಂತದಲ್ಲಿ ಪ್ರತಿ ದೇಹ ಬಂದದ್ದೇ ಭಗವಂತನ ಕಾಣಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ ಶಾಸ್ತ್ರ ಹೇಳ್ತಿರೋದ್ರಿಂದ ದೇಹದ ರಕ್ಷಣೆ ಮಾಡುವಾಗ ಕೆಲವು ಕೆಲಸಗಳನ್ನು ಮಾಡಬೇಕು. ಎಲ್ರಿಗೂ ಕೂಡ ಕೂತ್ಕೊಂಡು ತಪಸ್ಸು ಮಾಡಿ ಸಿದ್ಧಿಯನ್ನು ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಳ್ಳಿಕ್ಕೆ ಆಗೋದಿಲ್ಲ. ಆಹಾರ ಇಲ್ಲದೆ ಬದುಕುವವರು ಕೆಲವರಿದ್ದಾರೆ, ಆ ರೀತಿ ಎಲ್ರಿಗೂ ಮಾಡಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಆಗಲ್ಲ. ಹಾಗಾದರೆ ಅವರು ಮಾಡುವ ಕೆಲಸವನ್ನೇ ದೇವರ ಪೂಜೆಯನ್ನು ಹೇಗೆ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಈ ಗ್ರಂಥಗಳು ಹೇಳಿಕೊಟ್ಟಿವೆ, ಅಲ್ಲಿರುವ ಕಥೆಗಳು ನಿರೂಪಿಸಿಕೊಟ್ಟಿದೆ. ನಾನು ಈ ರೀತಿ ಬದುಕಬಹುದು ಅಂತ ನಮಗೆ ತೋರಿಸಿಕೊಡ್ತವೆ. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ನಿರಂತರ ಇಂಥ ಚಿಂತನೆಗಳು ನಾವು ಮಾಡಬೇಕು. ಪ್ರತಿಯೊಬ್ಬ ವ್ಯಕ್ತಿಗೂ ಕೂಡ ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಆದ ಸಾಮರ್ಥ್ಯ ಇರೋದರಿಂದ ನಮ್ಮ ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆಯಲ್ಲೂ ಕೂಡ ಅಷ್ಟು ಅವಕಾಶಗಳಿದೆ. ಯಾರು ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ಬೇಕಾದರೂ ಉಪಾಸನೆ ಮಾಡ್ಬೋದು, ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಬೇಕಾದ ಒಂದು ಅವಕಾಶಗಳಿದೆ. ನಿನ್ನೆ ದಿವಸ ಒಬ್ಬರು ಈ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆಯನ್ನು ಕೇಳಿದರು, ನಾವು ಒಂದು ಹೊಸ ರೀತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು ಆಯೋಜನೆ ಮಾಡೋಣ. ಅದೇನು ಅಂದರೆ, ವಾರದಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು ದಿವಸ, ಬುಧವಾರವೋ ಮಂಗಳವಾರವೋ ಸೋಮವಾರವೋ ಅಥವಾ ಯಾವುದೋ ಒಂದು ದಿವಸ ಎಲ್ಲ ಹಿಂದೂಗಳು ಸೇರಬೇಕು. ಸೇರಿ ಬೇರೆ ಮತಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ಒಂದು ಅಲ್ಲಿಯ ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಏನೆಲ್ಲ ಬೋಧನೆಗಳಾಗ್ತವೋ ಆ ರೀತಿಯ ಬೋಧನೆಗಳನ್ನು ಕೊಡಬೇಕು ಅಂತ. ಆವಾಗ ನಾನು ಚಿಂತನೆ ಮಾಡಿ ಹೇಳಿದೆ. ಆವಾಗ ಏನಾಯಿತು, ಇದು ಕೂಡ ಅಂಥದ್ದೇ ಒಂದು ಮತ ಆಗ್ತದೆ ಹೊರತು ನಮ್ಮ ಒಂದು ಒರಿಜಿನಾಲಿಟಿ, ನಮ್ಮ ಒಂದು ಸತ್ವವನ್ನು ಉಳಿಸ್ಕೊಂಡಂಗೆ ಆಗೋದಿಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ. ಯಾಕೆಂದರೆ ನಮ್ಮ ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆ ಹೇಗೆ ಅಂದರೆ, ಒಂದು ಉದಾಹರಣೆಗಾಗಿ ನಾನು ಇವತ್ತು ಮತ್ತೆ ಅದನ್ನು ಹೇಳ್ತೇನೆ. ಸನಾತನ ಧರ್ಮ ಅಂದರೆ ನಿಮ್ಮನ್ನು ತಗೊಂಡು ಹೋಗಿ ಒಂದು ಶೋರೂಮಿಗೆ ಬಿಡ್ತಾರೆ. ಆ ಶೋರೂಮಲ್ಲಿ ಹಲವಾರು ಬಗೆಯ ಇಂಜಿನ್ಸ್ ಇದೆ, ಹಲವಾರು ಬಗೆಯ ಟೈರ್ಸ್ ಇದೆ, ಹಲವಾರು ಬಗೆಯ ಬಾಡಿ ಇದೆ, ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆಗಳಿದೆ. ನಿಮಗೆ ಅವಕಾಶಗಳಿದೆ, ನೀವು ಯಾವ ಟೈರಾದರೂ ತೊಗೊಳ್ಬೋದು, ಯಾವ ಇಂಜಿನಾದರೂ ಹಾಕ್ಕೊಳ್ಬೋದು, ಯಾವ ಚಾಸಿಯನ್ನಾದರೂ ಹಾಕ್ಬೋದು, ನಿಮಗೆ ಬೇಕಾದ ಒಂದು ವಾಹನವನ್ನು ತಯಾರು ಮಾಡಿಕೊಳ್ಬಹುದು ಭಗವಂತನ ಕಡೆಗೆ ಹೋಗಲಿಕ್ಕೆ. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ತುಂಬ ಸಾಮರ್ಥ್ಯ ಉಳ್ಳವನು ಒಂದು ಫ್ಲೈಟ್ ತಯಾರು ಮಾಡಿದರೆ ಒಂದು ಗಂಟೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಮುಂಬೈಗೆ ಹೋಗ್ತಾನೆ. ಸಾಮರ್ಥ್ಯ ಇಲ್ಲ ಸಾಧಾರಣದವನು ಒಂದು ಸೈಕಲ್ ತಯಾರು ಮಾಡಿದರೆ ಸೈಕಲ್ ಎಷ್ಟು ಸ್ಪೀಡ್ ಹೋಗ್ಬೋದು ಅಷ್ಟು ಸ್ಪೀಡಲ್ಲಿ ದೇವರ ಬಳಿಗೆ ಹೋಗ್ತಾನೆ. ಬೈಕ್ ತಯಾರು ಮಾಡಲಿಕ್ಕಾಗುವವನು ಅದಕ್ಕಿಂತ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಹೋಗ್ಬೋದು, ಕಾರ್ ಇನ್ನೂ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಸೇಫಾಗಿ ಹೋಗ್ಬೋದು. ಅಥವಾ ನಾವು ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಎಕ್ಸಸೈಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ತೇವಲ್ಲ, ನಿಂತಲ್ಲೇ ಇರಬಹುದು, ಸುಮ್ಮನೆ ತುಳಿತಾ ಇರೋದಷ್ಟೇ, ಹಾಗೂ ಮಾಡ್ಬೋದು. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ಅಂತೂ ಎಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ಅವಕಾಶ ಇದೆ, ಎಲ್ಲರೂ ಕೂಡ ದೇವರಲ್ಲಿ ಹೋಗಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಪ್ರಯತ್ನ ಮಾಡಬಹುದು. ಇಂಥ ಒಂದು ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆ ಇರೋದು ಅದು ಸನಾತನ ಧರ್ಮದಲ್ಲಿ ಮಾತ್ರ ಅಂತ ಖಂಡಿತವಾಗಿ ಹೇಳಬಹುದು. ಅಥವಾ ಬೇರೆ ಯಾವುದೋ ಮತಗಳು ಇಂಥ ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆಯನ್ನು ಕಲ್ಪಿಸಿ ಕೊಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೇವೆ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದರೆ ಅವರು ಸನಾತನ ಧರ್ಮಕ್ಕೆ ಬಂದಾಯಿತು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಬಹುದು. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ಇದನ್ನು ಅರ್ಥ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಂಡಾಗ, ಇದನ್ನು ಅಳವಡಿಸ್ಕೊಂಡಾಗ ದೇಶದಲ್ಲಿರುವ ಎಲ್ಲ ಬಗೆಯ ಸಮಸ್ಯೆಗಳು ಅದು ಪರಿಹಾರ ಆಗ್ತದೆ. ಆ ನಿಟ್ಟಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಈ ವಿಶ್ವಾರ್ಪಣದ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮದ ಒಂದು ಆ ಚಿಂತನೆಯೊಂದಿಗೆ ಈ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮಗಳು ನಡೀತಾ ಬಂದಿದೆ. ವಿಶ್ವಾರ್ಪಣ ಎಂಬ ಹೆಸರಲ್ಲಿ ಅದು ನಮ್ಮ ಗುರುಗಳ ಹೆಸರಿದೆ, ವಿಶ್ವ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ ಒಂದು ಪಾರ್ಟ್ ಇದೆ. ಇವತ್ತು ನಾವು ಈ ಚಿಂತನೆ ಎಲ್ಲ ಮಾಡಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಮೂಲಭೂತ ಕಾರಣೀಭೂತರು ಅದು ಗುರುಗಳು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದರೆ ತಪ್ಪಾಗುವುದಿಲ್ಲ. ಅಂತಹ ವಿಶ್ವಪ್ರಿಯ ತೀರ್ಥರ ಒಂದು ಸಾರ್ಥಕವಾದ ಸನ್ಯಾಸ ಜೀವನದ ಒಂದು ಅವಸರ, ಒಂದು ಘಟ್ಟ. 50 ವರ್ಷಗಳು ಒಂದು ಯತಿಧರ್ಮವನ್ನು ಪಾಲನೆ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಂಡು ಬರುವುದು ಬಹಳ ಸುಲಭದ ಮಾತಲ್ಲ. ಅಂತಹ ಒಂದು 50 ವರ್ಷಗಳ ಪೂರೈಕೆ ಅದು ಮುಗಿತಾ ಇದೆ. ಅದು ನಾಳೆ ದಿವಸ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಅಂತ ಒಂದು ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮ, ಗುರುವಂದನಾ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮ ಅಂತಿದೆ. ಅದಕ್ಕೂ ತಾವು ಬನ್ನಿ, ನಿರಂತರವಾಗಿ ಇಂತಹ ಚಿಂತನೆಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವೆಲ್ಲ ಪಾಲ್ಗೊಳ್ಳೋಣ, ಮತ್ತೆ ಮತ್ತೆ ಜ್ಞಾನವನ್ನು ಪಡೀಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಪ್ರಯತ್ನ ಪಡೋಣ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇವತ್ತಿನ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮದ ಪ್ರಾರಂಭ ದ್ವಾದಶ ಸ್ತೋತ್ರದ ಅಂಶಗಳಿಂದ ಆಗಿದೆ. ಪ್ರದೇಶ ಆಚಾರ್ಯರು ಅದನ್ನು ನಡೆಸಿಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಆನಂತರ ಸಂಜೀವ ಸುವರ್ಣ ಅವರ ಬಳಗ ಯಕ್ಷಗಾನದ ಮೂಲಕವಾಗಿ ಒಂದು ಚಿಂತನೆಯನ್ನು ನಮ್ಮ ಮುಂದಿಟ್ಟಿದೆ. ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಜಟಾಯು ತನಗೆ ಶಕ್ಯ ಅಲ್ಲದ ವಿಷಯವನ್ನು ಪ್ರಯತ್ನ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದಾನೆ, ರಾಮನಿಗಾಗಿ ತನ್ನ ಪ್ರಾಣವನ್ನು ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾನೆ. ಪ್ರಾಣ ಹೋಗುವುದು ಒಂದಲ್ಲ ಒಂದು ದಿವಸ, ಅದು ನಿರ್ಧಾರಿತವಾದ ವಿಷಯವೇ. ಆದ್ದರಿಂದ ನಮ್ಮ ಪ್ರಯತ್ನ ಯಾವತ್ತೂ ಬಿಡಬಾರದು ಅನ್ನುವ ಸೂಚನೆಯು ಆ ಒಂದು ಯಕ್ಷಗಾನದಲ್ಲಿದೆ. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ಅಂತಹ ಪ್ರಯತ್ನಗಳು ನಮ್ಮಲ್ಲಿ ನಿರಂತರವಾಗಿ ಇರಬೇಕು, ಆಗ ರಾಮ ಬಂದು ನಮಗೆ ಮೋಕ್ಷ ಕೊಡ್ತಾನೆ ಅನ್ನುವ ಸೂಚನೆ ಅದರಲ್ಲಿದೆ. ಅಂತಹ ಒಂದು ಪ್ರಯತ್ನ ಮಾಡಿದಂತಹ ಸಂಜೀವ ಸುವರ್ಣ ಅವರ ಬಳಗಕ್ಕೂ ಕೂಡ ಈ ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ಅಭಿನಂದನೆಗಳನ್ನು ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇವತ್ತು ನಮ್ಮೊಟ್ಟಿಗೆ ನಿಮ್ಮೆಲ್ಲರ ಅಥವಾ ನಮ್ಮ ಒಂದು ಅಭಿಪ್ರಾಯವನ್ನು ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆಗಳ ಮೂಲಕ ಇವತ್ತು ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಜೋಸೆಫ್ ಅವರಿಗೆ ನಂದನ್ ಪ್ರಭು ಅವರು ಕೇಳಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅವರು ಕೂಡ ಇದರಲ್ಲಿ ತುಂಬ ಹಿಂದಿನಿಂದ ನಮ್ಮೊಟ್ಟಿಗೆ ಹಿಂದಿನಿಂದ ಇದ್ದು ಈ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮವನ್ನು ಚಂದಗೊಳಿಸುವಲ್ಲಿ ಪ್ರಯತ್ನಪಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅದೇ ರೀತಿ ನಮ್ಮವರಾದ ಜಗದೀಶ್ ಶೆಟ್ಟರಿದ್ದಾರೆ, ಎ ಪಿ ಭಟ್ರಿದ್ದಾರೆ, ನಮ್ಮ ಸೆಕ್ರೆಟರಿಗಳಿದ್ದಾರೆ, ಶಾಲೆಯ ಪ್ರಾಂಶುಪಾಲರುಗಳಿದ್ದಾರೆ, ಎಲ್ಲರೂ ಕೂಡ ಇದರಲ್ಲಿ ಭಾಗವಹಿಸಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ವಿಶೇಷ ಆಸ್ತಿಯಿಂದ ನೀವೆಲ್ಲರೂ ಕೇಳಿದ್ದೀರಿ. ಸ್ವಾಮಿಗಳ ಶಿಷ್ಯರಾದ ಕರ್ನೂಲ್ ಶ್ರೀನಿವಾಸಾಚಾರ್ಯರು ಕೂಡ ಇಲ್ಲಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ನಮ್ಮವರಾದ ನಮ್ಮ ಮಠದ ಎಲ್ಲ ಸಿಬ್ಬಂದಿ ವರ್ಗದವರು, ವಿಶೇಷವಾಗಿ ಗೋವಿಂದರಾಜರು, ಇವರೆಲ್ಲರೂ ಕೂಡ ಇದರಲ್ಲಿ ಭಾಗವಹಿಸಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಮುಂದೆಯೂ ನಾವು ಈ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮವನ್ನು ಒಂದು 3 ತಿಂಗಳಿಗೊಂದ್ಸಲ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನುವ ಒಂದು ಯೋಚನೆ ಇದೆ. ಆಗಲೂ ಕೂಡ ನೀವೆಲ್ಲ ಭಾಗವಹಿಸಿ ಒಂದಷ್ಟು ವಿಷಯಗಳನ್ನು ನಾವು ಪಡೆಯೋಣ. ಸಾಧ್ಯವಾದರೆ ಅದರ ಒಂದು ಅಂತರವನ್ನು ಇನ್ನೂ ಕಡಿಮೆ ಮಾಡೋಣ. ಬೇಗ 1 ತಿಂಗಳಿಗೊಂದ್ಸಲ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮವನ್ನು ಮಾಡಬಹುದು, ಅದು ಸಾಂದರ್ಭಿಕವಾಗಿ ನೋಡಿಕೊಂಡು. ಅಂತೂ ಇವತ್ತಿನ ಈ ಒಂದು ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮಕ್ಕೆ ಒಳ್ಳೆಯ ಮೆರುಗನ್ನು ತಂದುಕೊಟ್ಟು ತಮ್ಮಲ್ಲಿರುವ ಜ್ಞಾನವನ್ನು ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಕೊಡುವುದರ ಮೂಲಕ ಒಂದು ಕೃಷ್ಣದೇವರ ಸೇವೆಯನ್ನು ಮಾಡಿದಂತಹ ಜೋಸೆಫ್ ಅವರಿಗೆ ವಿಶೇಷವಾದ ಅಭಿನಂದನೆಗಳನ್ನು ಈ ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ಹೇಳ್ತಾ, ಅವರು ತುಂಬ ಅವರಿಗೆ ಬೇಡಿಕೆಗಳಿದೆ, ತುಂಬ ಪ್ರವಚನಗಳು ಅವರು ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇರ್ತಾರೆ. ಅಂಥದ್ರ ನಡುವೆ ಅದನ್ನು ಅವರನ್ನು ಬರುವ ಹಾಗೆ ಮಾಡಿದ ಅವರ ಮಗ ಕೂಡ ಇಲ್ಲಿದ್ದಾರೆ, ಸುರೇಶ್ ಅಂತ, ಅವರು ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಬಂದಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅವರಿಗೂ ಕೂಡ ಅಭಿನಂದನೆಗಳು. ಎಲ್ಲದಕ್ಕಿಂತ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಇಷ್ಟು ಹೊತ್ತು ಈ ಎಲ್ಲ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮವನ್ನು ಸಮಾಧಾನದಲ್ಲಿ ಕೇಳ್ತಾ, ಈ ಮೊಬೈಲ್ನ ಒಂದು ಯುಗದಲ್ಲಿ 5 ನಿಮಿಷ 10 ನಿಮಿಷಕ್ಕಿಂತ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಕೂರೋದೇ ಕಷ್ಟ. ಅಂಥದ್ರಲ್ಲಿ 2.5 ಗಂಟೆ ಸುಮಾರು ನೀವೆಲ್ಲ ಕೂತು ಕೇಳಿದ್ದೀರಿ. ಮುಂದೆಯೂ ಕೂಡ ಜ್ಞಾನಕ್ಕಾಗಿ ಇಂತಹ ಕೇಳುವಿಕೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಪಾಲ್ಗೊಳ್ಳಿ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳುವ ಮೂಲಕ 2 ಮಾತನ್ನು ಮುಗಿಸ್ತೇನೆ. ಕೃಷ್ಣಾರ್ಪಣಮಸ್ತು. ಹರಿವನ್ನ.
ಪರಮಪೂಜ್ಯ ಶ್ರೀ ಶ್ರೀ ಈಶಪ್ರಿಯ ತೀರ್ಥ ಶ್ರೀಪಾದರ ಪಾದ ಕಮಲಗಳಿಗೆ ಸಾಷ್ಟಾಂಗ ಪ್ರಣಾಮಗಳನ್ನು ಸಲ್ಲಿಸ್ತಾ, ಇಂದಿನ ಈ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮದಲ್ಲಿ ನಮ್ಮೊಂದಿಗೆ ಸಹಕರಿಸಿರುವ ಡಿ ಎ ಜೋಸೆಫ್ ಅವರ ಪುತ್ರ ಜೆ ಎಂ ಸುರೇಶ್ ಅವರು ವೇದಿಕೆಗೆ ಬಂದು ಸ್ವಾಮೀಜಿಯವರಿಂದ ಅನುಗ್ರಹ ಪಡಿಬೇಕಾಗಿ ಕೇಳಿಕೊಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೇನೆ. ಐ ರಿಕ್ವೆಸ್ಟ್ ಜೆ ಎಂ ಸುರೇಶ್ ಟು ಕಮ್ ಔಟ್ ಟು ದಿ ಡಯಾಸ್. ಇವತ್ತಿನ ವಿಶ್ವಾರ್ಪಣಂ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮವನ್ನು ಆಯೋಜಿಸುವಲ್ಲಿ ನಮ್ಮೊಂದಿಗೆ ಪಾಲ್ಗೊಂಡು ಇಂದಿನ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮವನ್ನು ನಿರ್ವಹಣೆ ಮಾಡಿ ಸಂವಾದ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮ ನಡೆಸಿಕೊಟ್ಟಂಥ ಪ್ರೊಫೆಸರ್ ನಂದನ್ ಪ್ರಭು ಅವರನ್ನು ಸಹ ವೇದಿಕೆಗೆ ಆಹ್ವಾನಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೇನೆ. ವಿಶ್ವಾರ್ಪಣಂ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮ ಎನ್ನುವಂಥದ್ದು ಪರಮಪೂಜ್ಯ ಸ್ವಾಮೀಜಿಯವರ ಕನಸಿನ ಕೂಸು. ಪರಮಪೂಜ್ಯ ಸ್ವಾಮೀಜಿಯವರು ತಮ್ಮ ಪರ್ಯಾಯಾವಧಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಈ ವಿಶ್ವಾರ್ಪಣಂ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮವನ್ನು ಆರಂಭಿಸಿದರು. ಪರ್ಯಾಯದ ನಂತರವೂ ಸಹ ಈ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮವನ್ನು ಮುಂದುವರಿಸಿಕೊಂಡು ಹೋಗಬೇಕು ಎನ್ನುವುದು ಅವರ ಆಶಯ. ಅದರಂತೆ ಪರ್ಯಾಯ ನಂತರದ ಅವಧಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಪ್ರಥಮ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮ ಇಂದು ನಡೆದಿದೆ. ಇನ್ನು ಮುಂದೆಯೂ ಸಹ ಇಂತಹ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮ ನಡೆಸುವಂಥ ಯೋಚನೆ ಸ್ವಾಮೀಜಿಯವರಿಗಿದೆ. ಈ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮಗಳ ಹಿಂದಿನ ರೂವಾರಿ ಪರಮಪೂಜ್ಯ ಸ್ವಾಮೀಜಿಯವರಿಗೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಸೇವಾ ಬಳಗದ ಪರವಾಗಿ ಭಕ್ತಿಪೂರ್ವಕ ಪ್ರಣಾಮಗಳೊಂದಿಗೆ ಕೃತಜ್ಞತೆಯನ್ನು ಸಲ್ಲಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೇವೆ. ಟುಡೇ ವಿ ಆರ್ ರಿಯಲಿ ಪ್ರಿವಿಲೇಜ್ ಟು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಎ ರಿನೌಂಡ್ ಪರ್ಸನಾಲಿಟಿ ಶ್ರೀ ಡಿ ಎ ಜೋಸೆಫ್ ಆಸ್ ಚೀಫ್ ಗೆಸ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ವಿಶ್ವಾರ್ಪಣಂ ಪ್ರೋಗ್ರಾಮ್. He has enlightened us on different aspects of Sanatana Hindu Dharma and answered many questions which were lingering in our mind for a long time. On behalf of Krishna Seva Balaga and Adamaru Mata, I express sincere gratitude to him. Indina karyakramadalli namma aahvanavanna mannisi palgondantaha Adamaru Mata shikshana samsthegala karyadarshigalige, ಕೋಶಾಧಿಕಾರಿಯವರಿಗೆ, ಪ್ರಾಂಶುಪಾಲರುಗಳಿಗೆ ಹಾಗೂ ಎಲ್ಲ ಶಿಕ್ಷಕ ಬಂಧುಗಳಿಗೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಸೇವಾ ಬಳಗ ಹಾಗೂ ಅದಮಾರು ಮಠದ ಪರವಾಗಿ ಕೃತಜ್ಞತೆಯನ್ನು ಸಲ್ಲಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೇವೆ. ಪತ್ರಿಕಾ ಮಾಧ್ಯಮದವರು ನಮ್ಮೊಂದಿಗಿದ್ದು ಈ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮದ ವಿವರಣೆಯನ್ನು ಬೇರೆಡೆಗೆ ಹಂಚಲಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅವರಿಗೂ ಸಹ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಸೇವಾ ಬಳಗ ಮತ್ತು ಅದಮಾರು ಮಠ ಋಣಿಯಾಗಿದೆ. ಈ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮ ನಿರ್ವಹಣೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಸಹಕರಿಸಿದ ಪ್ರೊಫೆಸರ್ ನಂದನ್ ಪ್ರಭು ಅವರಿಗೂ ನಾವು ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಸೇವಾ ಬಳಗ ಮತ್ತು ಅದಮಾರು ಮಠದ ಪರವಾಗಿ ಕೃತಜ್ಞತೆಯನ್ನು ಸಲ್ಲಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೇವೆ. ಈ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮ ತಯಾರಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಹಲವರು ಸಹಕರಿಸಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅವರೆಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ಸಹ ನಾವು ಋಣಿಯಾಗಿದ್ದೇವೆ. ಇಂದಿನ ಈ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮದಲ್ಲಿ ಹಲವಾರು ಸಂಘ ಸಂಸ್ಥೆಗಳ ಪದಾಧಿಕಾರಿಗಳು ಹಾಗೂ ಸದಸ್ಯರು ಬಹಳ ಉತ್ಸಾಹದಿಂದ ಪಾಲ್ಗೊಂಡು ಇದುವರೆಗೂ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮವನ್ನು ಕೇಳಿದ್ದೀರಿ. ನಿಮಗೆ ಶ್ರೀಕೃಷ್ಣ ಸೇವಾ ಬಳಗ ಮತ್ತು ಮಾರು ಮಠದ ಪರವಾಗಿ ಕೃತಜ್ಞತೆಯನ್ನು ಸಲ್ಲಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೇನೆ.